We blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly. It's just about time people stop believing the report that is given to you out of that which man demands. Man has a demand that places upon you certain behaviors and actions and thoughts and beliefs. And you bow to it. You need to stop. You need to come under the rule of the Word of God and live by His Word and His Word alone. You need to let God tell you who you are instead of letting people around you define who you are. Letting things define you. Come on. Hallelujah. Somebody asks, next time somebody asks you what you do, you should say, I do heaven. I mean, what do you do for a living? I do, for a living? I do Holy Ghost. I do, It's about time everybody get bold and intense about the confession of their faith. It's about time God's people lay hold on those wonderful blessings and promises that was once delivered unto the saints. Come on, man. It's about time God's people quit running to the doctor and start demanding that which God supplied. A guy in the second century, Christologos, he was a minister, actually right at the change of the 3rd century, 300s, in the 300s. In what we would pretty much look at as the Alexandrian church, a backslidden state, compared to the Antiochians or those who followed on with the tradition of the Lord Jesus Christ. In other words, he was of the Church of Rome. And you know what he said? He said, why should we pay for that which has freely been given to us? For does not the scripture say, these signs shall follow them that believe in my name, you cast out devils, speak with new tongues, take up serpents, if you drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt you, and you lay hands on the sick and you shall recover. A verse of scripture that people want to say today doesn't even belong to the text. But because Christologos quoted it, they got a gulp. You heard me. All you folks tuning in to just, you don't know why. You just have to. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody said, oh, if you could be a better communicator, you'd be more successful. Listen, I'm a good communicator. You just don't like what I'm communicating. Somebody said, how can you say a good communicator? Because I'm communicating by the Holy Ghost. I have no confidence in, I have a vote of no confidence in myself. In fact, I got such a vote of no confidence in myself, I'm denying it. I'm saying you have no right to influence me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm taking up my cross to lay down my life as Christ Jesus has shown me. To lay down my life, not to live for the will of man, because I wasn't born by the will of man or by the will of the flesh. But I was born by the Spirit of God, by the will of God. Hallelujah. And that's just the beautiful thing. And in that context, we ceased, you know, from sin. Whoa. You're gulping again. Yeah, well, that's what Peter meant when he said it in 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. Go read it. That's Jesus, what Jesus was talking about in John 1, 14. Go read it. And the list goes on. He said, I want it His way. If I believe the miracle God created, there's 100 million galaxies out there and we're still counting. Galaxies. 100 million. How many solar systems are in each galaxy? He created all that. What do you think about what He's done for you and me? That is the small task. Those are the little things He did. About time we start believing all these things that God has done and I start accepting it, confessing it, believing it, laying hold on it. Say it so. I don't understand it. It's an unspeakable gift. It's beyond all that I can comprehend. But it's got to be because God said so. And I say that that's what it is. And I'm not going to have the identity of any other identity. I'm not going to be conformed to any other image. I'm going to be conformed to the image of the Son. The one, Galatians 1:16, to whom it was revealed that his son, Christ Jesus, should be revealed in him, said in Romans 8:29, to be conformed to the image of the Son. That is what God predestinated and foreknew us to do. We want to talk about predestination, foreknowledge, and what God knew and what you knew. Why don't you just do what it was he predestinated and foreordained? We want to talk about whether you're filled or whether you're baptized, and they are neither. They just want to argue about it. Have you noticed that? Yeah. Have you done that? Don't do that no more. Do what these things aren't supposed to sit around and debate. Huh? Dichotomize and dissect and diagram. Hallelujah. Hurabakadaste. You can diagram the triune man and talk about the meaning of the priest underwear all you want. But God's purpose for his fullness and glory to dwell on the inside of you. Father's purpose that you begin to function in divine power. God, his purpose that you understand what it means to walk in oneness with him and union with him. His purpose that you understand what it means to have this wonderful realm of the utterances of God where you prophesying. Where you're speaking forth things that you don't even know anything about. And it's so exhilarating. It's so full of ecstasy and rapture. I know people say that rapture is not in the Bible. Listen, there's not any English word in the Bible. Hello. It's all Greek words and Hebrew words. But the English translation is rapture. Or catching away, whatever your flavor of translation is. Raptured, caught away in the Holy Ghost. It's for you and for me. Come on. And you know what? It isn't going to take long. It isn't going to be long. And there's going to be a people who are going to hear the voice of God, not harden their heart anymore, and they're going to rise up and they're going to display that which God purchased for us at Calvary, brought to pass in the life that he gave when he raised Jesus from the dead and brought forth that experience and display and the outpouring of it when he gave us his Holy Ghost, his Holy Spirit. That's going to be a new model. It's going to be a new model. And you know, people say to me, why do you like church so much? Because it's heaven. I love heaven. And I'm in heaven when I'm in church. You know, we have resident impartations here. God placed in his church apostles, prophets, teachers. It's giftings, healings, working of miracles. The manifestation of the Holy Ghost is here. This, I'm telling you right now, the church of the Lord Jesus Christ is something that the Lord himself loves so much that he gave his own self for it. Huh? I'm telling you, Jesus at 12 years old, he showed us what it meant to be about the Father's business. Did he show us what it meant to be about the Father's business at the age of 12? Yes, he did. Mary and Joseph, finding him in the temple, said, we sought earnestly for you. He said, why did you search so earnestly for me? Did you know I'd be about my Father's business? What is Father's business defined as? Being in his house. Because God's got a separate place. There's no TV in here. There's no clocks in here unless you brought one. I didn't bring one. I was standing in the pulpit one night. And I was looking at this giant clock. And it kept getting bigger and bigger. And the Holy Spirit said to me, why isn't that facing the people? Why is that facing you? And I began to become enraged by the Holy Ghost. The zeal of the Lord began to eat me up. I began to understand the idolatry that was lifted up in the house of God, where God the Holy Ghost wasn't in charge, man mandating by the clock of time and human existence and their own purposes that they've defined based around their own individual interests and need. Trying to tell me what I'm going to do, what I'm not going to do. No. Jesus went away, left me in charge. And whether you know it or not, he went away and left you in charge too. Hallelujah. It's just all I've done is believe it. You can sit around and go, oh, I can't believe he said. Did you hear what he said? Jesus left and left.
Jesus went away and left him in charge.
Yeah, that's exactly what he said. All authority is given to me in heaven and earth. You go. Go with my miracle ministry. Go with my miracle life. I'm going to empower. You cannot bear witness of me. You can't testify of me. You can't be valid witnesses of me and of what I've done until you receive the same power that Father gave me. I'm going to pour it out on you. The Holy Ghost without limits. So what will we do then? He says, what will we do then? He said, we'll pray in the Spirit or pray in the Holy Ghost. And he made that real clear what that was. That's Pentecost. Paul did it more than them all. And we'll pray with the understanding also. Well, what understanding? The understanding that God gives, not that the understanding that your perceptions give, that your concerns, your worries, your interests give. Who wants to live out their life based upon your own human understanding when God has given to us the mind of Christ, the mind of the Spirit? Why? Because we've abdicated. We simply wanted to have it our way and not lay hold on that life that God has given to us, because you're going to have to quit being lazy. You're going to have to quit being distracted with other earthly interests. I'm just going to lay it down. I'm going to lay it down, man. Listen, quit being lazy, pray in the Holy Ghost, and being strengthened and empowered with that resource which God has given you. And quit just putting it on the back stuff. What should we do then? We sing in the Spirit. We got to sing in the language of heaven, tongues. That's the church defined. One day the Spirit of the Lord said to me, he says, my church isn't about singing and preaching. Said it's about flowing in the Holy Ghost that produces singing and preaching. Hallelujah. We want to just sing and preach. No! Be filled with the Spirit. Be baptized in the Holy Ghost. Same thing. Because the Lord made being filled with the Spirit and being baptized in the Holy Ghost equal. He wanted to sit around and talk about what it meant to be filled in the Old Testament. People, hello. Old Testament is over. People. It's over. It's over. We know in the New Covenant. With new definitions. Jesus said, you'd be baptized in the Holy Ghost, with the Holy Ghost, not many days from now. That's what he said. And on that day when they were baptized in the Holy Ghost, the scripture says, and they were all filled with the Spirit. Acts 2:4. I referred to Acts 1:5 and Acts 1:8, and then I showed you the clear connection of Acts 2:4. And I can go on and give you more, but that's not the topic tonight. I just want to take away all this strife and all these bickering, all this dichotomizing and leveling and degrees. We're not the Masons. You're not trying to get a black belt. Degrees. It's about whether or not you're going to participate. God's given us of all his fullness. And of all of his fullness have all we received. That is crazy. That is amazing. That is unbelievable. That is wild. What on earth does that mean? Nothing. However, it has a great meaning in heaven. In the heavenly. The earthly is subjected. The wind and the wave must obey. The winds and the wave. Sickness and disease must. All the elements must obey. The fire cannot burn lest the master says so. Cannot consume that which you say nature has dictated. No, neither can the flame kindle upon me. Even Israel in a backslidden state under the judgments of God says, and when you pass through the waters, you shall not drown. Neither shall the flame kindle upon you. For I am Yehovah, your God. Or as some of the Haredim say, Yahweh, your God. As the English translation says, I am the Lord. Just to say Hashem. But I don't have to be just the Lord. Just say Adonai, rather. I don't have to just be talking about. Of course, it's reverential, and I understand. I am totally all for that. And another thing, people need to be throwing Father's name around anyways. So I'm kind of a little bit on that side. Let everybody just say Yahweh or tetragrammaton. I don't care. Fine. Until he becomes your papa and you've
and you've trembled before his presence, you probably didn't even know him. You know what I'm saying? But yet he's so good. He's so merciful. He just says, come on in. He says, you people who are full of, you ragtag, corrupted folks, come on in. He says, those who are near and those, anybody who wants, come on in. Here, take the blood and come on in. How about come on in and don't depart anymore? Father's amazing. Father's amazing. He separated me into a realm where Satan cannot touch me. And we talk about these things and people look at us with this weird look, a question mark in one eye and almost a, I'm going to kill you with the other. What are you saying now? You're taking away from us our excuse to live a purely human existence. Please allow me to. Please allow me to beg you to be changed tonight, to be reconciled unto God. Hallelujah. To be reconciled. To be bone of his bone and flesh of his flesh. Whew. Whew. This is a great mystery, but I speak of Christ and his church. Whew. Hallelujah. Mambrandaya. Brought unto him. Breda ziloya pa. Hallelujah, that he may be headship, leadership, that he may be the one responsible over our lives, that we are privileged to follow and be submitted to be the one to provide all that we have need of. Be the issue, the husband in the house. To have Father God, our Father. Oh, Maserinea. Oh, how amazing. Oh, how amazing. You know, I just want you to begin to start taking a hold of God and flowing in the anointing and then flowing in the presence of that which the Holy Spirit supplies, where you just begin to break out in worship and song and singing. You know, many, many, many times it's like we got to take people every time. We got to, you know, take them through the washing of the blood and the washing of the regeneration and the washing and refreshing of the water of the Spirit. Then by the end of the meeting, suddenly the Holy Ghost begins to flow. And now finally the Holy Ghost is about beginning to flow and have free course within your life. And song and praise is starting to come out and rapture is there. And now it's time to go home. It's wrong. It's just supposed to start that way. People want to come in. Check into church for a couple hours and go live their own life and then say that they are accurate witness. God hates a false witness. And try to describe the Word of God, the experience of walking in God, Christ Jesus, and walking in God the Holy Ghost, and say that they understand it. When they live in their life completely offline of heaven, they're more impacted by earthly things than they are heaven. It's true. I watch people get all worried and upset. The other day, someone said to me, well, I can't help it. I just worry about things. I said, don't worry about it. Don't be concerned about it. Be thoughtful, but don't be concerned. You can be thoughtful. Now, I know in our translation, the scripture says, take no thought. But literally, it's do not be concerned. Do not worry about it. It's okay to be thoughtful as to whether or not you have gas in the tank of the car. In other words, you understand what I'm saying? Because we want you to get here. We want you to call us up. Hey, can somebody please come bring me gas? Phew, I didn't think of it. Oh, if God told you to do something, how many of you, if you didn't have any gas in your tank, you'd just get in the car and drive anyways? God tells you to go to church. He said, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. And all the more as the day approaches. I'm at newsflash, the day is approaching.
Memo. Reality check. Hey, the day is approaching.
And they were meeting two times a day in the context of that. I believe that Father's been interested in seeing personal relationship cultivated in your life where nobody else can see you. In your living room. In your bedroom. In your backyard. Ooh. I mean, I think about it. How Father feels when he's like, I'm ready to pour out my spirit upon you, but you got to watch Barney Miller, and what's after that? Law and Order or whatever? And now you're too tired, you're going to bed. And that's what you think about the gift. And that's what you believe about the manifest presence. And so we just go round and round. It's about time God's people take up the anointing that Father supplies and begin to build upon it. See, we are laborers together with the Lord of his husbandry and of his building. And Father in his husbandry is laboring to bring forth a precious fruit of the earth and has long patience for it. It's a fruit that Jesus described in John chapter 15, to whatever we ask the Father, he would do it. It has to be cultivated. You have to give yourself to the development of the Holy Ghost in your life. And I'm going to talk to you about that here. I'm going to begin to minister to you and out of Romans chapter 8 and begin to help you to understand how now, having begun in the Spirit, you now matured by the Holy Ghost. That God, who's began a good work in you, will finish it. But you have to participate, because he's not going to finish it while you're doing something else. I pray in the name of Jesus that you begin to understand what it means to just walk around all the time being continually refreshed and filled with the Stiparana Neshipayati. Man, you know what? If that's not flowing out of me, it's like the red light on your car, that you're out of oil. You know, they told me early on in life, if the red light comes on and says no more oil, pull over immediately. Because it's there, you got it, you're going to break down. It's going to explode on you. Huh? Come on. I pray there's not a single person in this place that would allow yourself to go without this wonderful, rich empowerment and strengthening and manifest glory of Christ Jesus and the power of the Holy Spirit strengthening us. The wonderful realms of Pentecost. He would say, oh, well, you know, I was baptized a long time ago and lost the English language. On that day that I was baptized, the Holy Ghost, with this, you should lose the English language every day. Did you know I can lose the English? I better be careful. I know a place. I know a realm. It's easily activated before I give myself to it continually. The scripture says be continually baptized in the Holy Ghost. Somebody said, oh, the scripture says be continually filled. And I know what it says. Be continually baptized in the Holy Ghost. Because that's what it means to be continually filled with the Spirit, or to be filled with the Spirit, speaking yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. We want to argue about it rather than have it. We want to debate it, break it down, say, well, are we sure that it was in the original, you know, in the original writings? Yes. God watches over his word to perform it. This is not given by man. This is not of men. It's eternal. Not one jot, not one tittle can pass away till it's all fulfilled. It should be security enough for all of us. Ha probosina meneia ti palo. Huh? That's just your average little, you know, da-da-da-da-da-da, la-la-la-la-la-la. You with me? Huh? That's the supply of the Holy Ghost that comes from participating. Astabegaranande will change the atmosphere. Your very presence can change the atmosphere. I am so provoked that a few passionate queers, homosexuals, immoral, reprobate people can make a disciple of this nation while we sit around and pat each other on the back on how anointed and mighty we are. I'm telling you right now, it's because we lack passion. Should I go through that again? Queers, reprobate mind, perverted, immoral people. Because I'm telling you right now, yeah, adultery is bad. Yeah, fornication is bad. But I'm telling you, homosexuality is to change the law and order of God. It is the worst perversion known to humanity. And we have been so dead in the water, as it were, that we allow Satan such authority, such a preeminence.
We want to act like it's a small thing. It isn't. Our government has said God is no longer our God. The highest court of the land has ruled yet once again to exalt immorality and everything that would defy God. Why can't we turn it? Because that which a man is overcome by, the same as he brought in bondage to, subjected to. And if the church is under in any way the control and the influence of a satanic realm, we have no ability to stop it. We have no ability to stop the advancements of hell. It's about time God's people recognize that it's time to come out from among them. It's time to be separate. It's time to now say, look, Lord, I belong to you. I'm going to let, you know what? I'm not going to allow anything to exist in my life that is not of you. But if you, by the Holy Ghost, put to death everything that is not supposed to exist in your life. That's what Romans says. You want to argue about all the various different Greek nuances there. Give me a break. It's very clear what the Lord is saying. I heard the Spirit of the Lord saying, I beheld among those void of understanding, those simple ones are small-minded thinking people who are captivated by sexual immorality. You hear the proverb? You hear what the prophet Isaiah said and what Peter said? You know, now has never been so a time where it could be so fulfilled. Having eyes full of adultery cannot cease from sin. To whom is reserved the everlasting chains of hell. People don't want to hear that. I'm telling you right now, you got sin in your life, you're on your way to a place called hell. And I'm talking about, when I say you have sin in your life, I'm talking about you practicing sin. It's an ongoing thing that you give place to. We understand, listen, there are things that belong in the body that are just natural that the Lord created and that are good. You need to get married. Someone said, I can't find the right one. Find the first one, we'll have you. And then learn how to walk in love. Amen. Yeah, because we created this infatuation, this romantic, demon-possessed love. It has nothing to do with relationship love, God love. Hallelujah. 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 One friend of mine, a mighty man of God, and somebody come to him and say, well, listen, you please pray for me. I've just been praying, believing God for a wife. And he just immediately stopped and said, is there any women here believing God for a husband? And then he'd say, is anybody look interesting? You like him? You like her? Okay, it's a done deal. Now get. Oh, we want to have this fantasy instead of reality. We want to walk in love as we define it to be rather than as God the Holy Ghost has defined it. We want to live out an existence as we define it, as has been created in the realms of men's ideology, philosophy, and tradition, rather than be filled with the Holy Ghost. Holy Spirit taught me about a love that there's nothing in this earth that is I've seen any similitude of it. Father showed us the love that he has when he spared not his own son, but offered him up for the sins of us all. I'm in the position now of receiving freely all things from him. I'm not arguing, begging, pleading. I'm saying thank you. You're amazing, God. I believe the word. God's spoken, it is so. It's done, it's mine. Hallelujah. Amen. I go instantly from feeling bad to feeling fine just because I believe what he said. You want to step into this inheritance? You want to live in this inheritance as heir of God and come and inherit with Jesus? Then you must be willing to meditate or literally recite his word that you may be strong and very courageous. That was the wisdom that God gave Joshua in Joshua chapter 1, verse 8 and verse 10. And that's changed. He's the same God. Nothing changed. His word works the same. His word works mightily in you and me that believe. Amen. His word works mightily, but we've got to believe. If we don't believe Christ is in us, if we don't believe we're the temple of the Holy Ghost, if we don't believe that we're one with the Father, if we don't believe that we're heirs of God and go and heirs of Jesus, if we don't believe that this authority has been endued to, empowered to us as the sons of God, given to us, if we don't believe that Jesus has all authority in earth right now. I said he has all authority in earth right now.
Hallelujah.
He's head over all principality and power and might and dominion. Yeah. The Father's raised up many judgments against the church. Islam was raised up as a judgment against the church in the 7th and 8th century because of the vile and immoral state that the church had come to. And Islam almost completely destroyed the church. They were hiding in the caves of Vienna, all that was left of the popular church, the Roman church. It was a scourge against it. Islam is not the Antichrist religion. It's far more sinister than that. It's far more demonic than that. It's a Luciferian cult. It's that which Nimrod was doing. That interaction of angels with men is far worse than anything that people have imagined. People have been imagining things every generation. Somebody's got their Hitler. Somebody's got their, you know, we're living under the seals. And started, hasn't even started yet. Can you imagine the devastation of the book of Revelation if should it start, should the seals begin to be removed from off of the treasure chest of the word of life? Before that word can be opened, before the announcements of the eternal kingdom can be made, the seals have to be broken. The judgments of God have to be poured out, which results, of course, you know, in the trumpet judgments and the vile judgments. One-fourth of the earth of humanity, the population of humanity, right at the very beginning is knocked out. One-fourth of approximately 7 billion people. That's a lot of people. Right? That's almost 2 billion. There's never been a devastation in the history of men. And that isn't even demarcating the big events where blood will flow 4 foot deep, 3 to 4 foot deep for 180 miles. From Syria all the way down to the lower regions of Edom, the upper region of Saudi Arabia. Here's what we have to do. We have to do Acts 2, 38, 39. We have to repent and be converted and receive the gift of the Holy Ghost to now walk in the gift of the Holy Ghost. Here's what people want to do. They just want to stand around and repent, 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 repent. We're going to repent for everything we can think of. We're going to repent for what we did to Native Americans. We're going to repent for what we did to the people from Africa. We're going to repent, and we're going to repent, and we're going to repent for what we did yesterday. We're going to repent for what we did tomorrow. We're going to repent, and 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 we're going to all come together, and we're going to feel bad about ourselves once again. Hello. It's time to go on to perfection now. It's time to grow up and mature, not laying again in a foundation of repentance from dead works and faith towards God. It's time now that we understand we get to now live in God. Hallelujah. Everybody just wants to die. How about live? Amen. How about live? I mean, I was ministering. I was so blessed to be able to be allowed by the Holy Ghost to go and minister to the house church of China. And all these folks are going to die in the kingdom. and die as martyrs in the unreached people groups. I said, how about let's live? How about let's go and live? How about let's go and live for Jesus? Praise God, you can only really live for Jesus because you're willing to die, but let's get our faith properly focused over here. Let's go live. Let's go live gloriously. Let's go live gloriously. Let's go live in the signs and the wonders and the miracles tonight in the morning when you wake up. Let's no longer live after human ability. Let's no longer live under the ordinances of this natural world when God has placed you in a heavenly realm and given you authority, even as he gave to his only begotten Son that authority, which was modeled for us. Authority over the wind and the wave, master of all the physical elements, to say to the sea, you must now congeal under my feet and hold me up. Authority and power to tread upon every work of Satan. People act like Adam's disobedience is greater than Christ Jesus' obedience. They act like the power and the influence of demon spirits is greater than the effect of God the Holy Spirit. You hear people talk about it all the time. Are we under the attack of the devil? The devil's attacking us. Why? Why? First of all, why would he even be interested in attacking you? What are you doing of such significance? Are you with me? And secondly, you should be under the shadow and the glory of the Almighty. Job had a hedge. You baptized in the fire and the glory. How can he access you, man? It's wrong thinking. It's not faith. It's unbelief. The devil's attacking me. No, you just give in place to the devil. You living with him. You cohabitating. See, people say right really what's going on in their life. It come right out of their mouth. They'll speak it right out. They'll act it out. You can't hide. All you got to do is behave. All you got to do is listen to what's coming out of your mouth. You understand who you are. You understand whether you've been born of the incredible seed by the word of God, and the word of God lives and abides in you, and you live by the word of God or not. Or whether you live by popular opinion, or you live by your fears and your concerns and your worries, or whatever. It's all this testifying continually, and then all you have to do is repent, be converted, and receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Somebody said, well, I've already repented, I've already been converted, I've already received the gift of the Holy Ghost. But somehow you departed away into unbelief and doubt. You begin to model after men instead of being conformed to the image of the Son. You started walking in human spirit instead of the Holy Spirit. You started walking in the human condition instead of the heavenly image and the glory. You gave yourself to be fashioned after shame rather than yielding to the glory, the unlimited glory, the same glory that Christ Jesus displayed on the Mount of Transfiguration. And thus he said, be not conformed to this world, but be transfigured. Not no caterpillar going to a butterfly. Jesus wasn't a caterpillar going to a butterfly on the Mount of Transfiguration. That word was sanctified on the Mount of Transfiguration. And thus when we read it in Romans 12, we're going to translate it the same way. Be not conformed to this world, but be transfigured, because you think different now. Oh, the renewing of the mind. Well, you tell me what the renewing of the mind is then. You just tell me what the renewing of the mind is, because it's taking words, abstract concepts, and trying to impose them upon people that have no way to put it as a practical reality in their lives. It doesn't even say that in the Greek language. It's just a common way of saying, think different. Yeah. Well, how different are you going to think? Think what God said about you. You one with them. You raised up together with them. You seated with them in a heavenly realm. And then we want to reduce it. We want to reduce it. We want to, oh, well, it's, you know, it's not real. It's positional. What's that mean? What does that mean? Whoever came up with this idea that it's not a true experience, but it's something that is positional only. Well, this is so far from the truth, because an experience of conversion takes place with a new heart and a new spirit, and he puts his Holy Spirit on the inside of us, and then it is an experience. I'm telling you right now, if your hair is on fire, that will be an experience. And he's going to set your whole being on fire. Amen. Hallelujah.
He's going to fill you with his glory. That's an experience. Hallelujah.
I'm telling you right now, go outside. Open up your car door. Put your hand in between the car door and the car. Slam it. You're going to have an experience, and as a result, you're going to let out a shout. I'm telling you, just let something cross your will. Let something go down that you don't like or that was contrary to your plan. You're going to also let out a yell. Yells from hell, so shout to the Lord. Come on now. People don't want to shout in the church. They want to go yell in the home place, in the workplace. They don't want the shout of the Lord. They'd rather have a yell from hell. Come on now. Ah, tu bene, Shikaya. Ask to be, receive. How the Lord says, earn. Earn. No, he says, receive. Ha! He said, I got this payment plan for you. No, he says, gift. Gift. Payment plan of the Holy Ghost. Gift of the Holy Ghost. All you got to do is agree with God. All you got to do is say, okay. Two cannot walk together unless they agree. All you got to do is agree. This is me. I know you look at it and go, how can this be me? How can this be me? This looks like somebody so glorious, so wonderful, so highly favored of God. This looks like someone so special. Beyond anything that I could ever imagine of myself. That's salvation for you. That's the gift of life for you. Oh, could you just begin to believe? You will. I mean, you sit around here. I'm telling you, I love watching people come in here and just sit. Who just, you know, you don't argue. You just absorb. There's people who argue in their mind all the time. Everything goes through a filter of what they think. That is, most of everything I say gets stuck on the other side. Those filters don't work for me. Those filters aren't that you ain't gonna change. Nothing's gonna change. You're gonna look like and be. I'm not gonna talk about that. I praise God. People just come in here and just absorb. And they just say, okay, I'm gonna be fashioned after this, and just let the Spirit of the Lord. You just let the Word of God go forth into you. You let the Spirit of the Lord do His work, and it's just beautiful. You just turn into this beautiful person. You turn into this wonderful person. Conform to the image of the Son. Conform to the image of Christ Jesus. It's a wonderful, beautiful person. Made in His image and His likeness after righteousness and true holiness. You begin at all of these things that God gifted us with. You believe, and the outworking of it then is made visible at seeing this glorious presence, the Spirit of the Lord, that brings such peace where there was once worry, where there was once fear, where there was once sickness. I went out there and prayed for this man this morning. He was totally thrashed by demon spirits. And he's come sit in the meeting. I just want a quick prayer and a shake. And a handshake. Quick prayer and a handshake. That's all. You know, just give a quick prayer. And I'm going to go to the next person, get prayed for them by them as well. No, you need to come sit in the meeting. And expect a miracle. And expect change. And expect every word that goes forth. You're sitting on the edge of your seat in anticipation, ready to do everything that God has said to do, to be conformed to everything, recognizing that when the word goes forth, the power of the Holy Ghost is there to supply all that God has purposed for your life. Rather than continuing being bogged down, you've got to understand your people. The Lord gives us gifts. He gives us discerning of spirits. He gives us word of knowledge. I understand very pointedly what's going on in your life. And if you would just become transparent and allow God to do what it is He wants to do, then we could speak very specific to you and tell you, this is the problem. Don't give yourself to that anymore. Don't yield your members. Don't yield your emotion. Don't yield your thinking. Don't yield your manner of living after that anymore, and help you understand it's going to be a fight, because that thing believes it owns you. It's imposed itself upon you and has given you a identity and a personality that has nothing to do with reality.
The Word of God to transform you. The Word of God creates. Hallelujah. The Word of God makes all things new. The Spirit of the Lord transforms us. The Spirit of the Lord makes all things new. He continually refreshes us, empowers us, strengthens us. There's no growing in the realms of God in the manner and life of Christ Jesus, but by the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And the beautiful thing of it is that we get to grow in grace. We get to grow in a divine provision, but we can't have it our own way. You just, come on, man. You just like little children following the leader. You need to be converted and become like a little child. Hallelujah. You need to say that you of yourself, you don't have any understanding. You don't have any knowledge. And you need to come to recognize that you can't do nothing without him. See, some people say, well, there's a lot of people doing a lot of different things and they don't have Jesus. So why don't you more perfectly define that? You can do nothing that matters anything without him. You can do nothing concerning his life, his ways, his glory, the things that he has, the things that he's purposed for us to be, and the things that he's purposed for us to do without him. We've all received an anointing from him, and the anointing teaches us to continually dwell in Jesus. The anointing breaks off every yoke. I've got a yoke-breaking anointing that was given to me to dwell in Christ Jesus, and he don't have no yokes. He don't have any problems. I'm staying with him. I'm staying with him. People want to pull me and draw me and drag me into the world of men. I refuse to exist in the world of men. I've been segregated, separated, partitioned off into the realms of God the Holy Ghost, into the kingdom of the dear Son. I belong to the Father. He has a jealous love over me. I want you to understand the same gospel that I'm talking about for you as well. Because if you'll begin to walk in the communication of the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of truth, who's come to lead us and guide us into all the truth, to show us everything that the Father has, that he's given us everything that he has, that all that the Father has belongs to Christ Jesus, because Father purposed that all the fullness of divine power should dwell in Christ Jesus bodily, and all those things he's given to us. And the Holy Spirit's the one who comes and reveals them to us and displays those things to us. So in that realm, there is no condemnation. There's therefore now no condemnation of those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Holy Ghost. Walking after the Holy Ghost, he's going to comfort your heart. He's going to assure your heart before God. He's your helper. He's the one who brings this peace, which is this fellowship and union with God. There is therefore now no condemnation. There is no fear. I mean, that's why it's connected. With he's not giving us the spirit of bondage whereby we would, live under the realms of fear, but he's sent forth the spirit of his Son into a heart whereby we cry, Abba, Father. God is my dad. That's what the Holy Spirit ministers. He doesn't minister otherness. He ministers oneness. He doesn't minister just friendship. He ministers heirship. By faith, Abraham was made the heir of the world to come. Hallelujah. And so you and I, because we have the same faith. Jesus said, Abraham saw my day. Hallelujah. That's what he was looking at there on Mount Moriah when he was ready to offer up his son as a sacrifice. And behold, a ram is caught in the thicket. And the Lord had provided for himself a lamb, a sacrifice. And he saw Jesus that day. All you and I need to do is begin to see Jesus. The one who knew no sin, who became sin for us, that we may be... The one who knew no sin, let me get this, help you understand this. The one who knew no sin, but became the sin sacrifice for us, sin offering. A chatat of the Hebrew language. You could just translate chatat, sin. The chatat means sin offering. He didn't become sin, personified sin. It'd be wrong to even think of it. It just is the same as a chatat offering or sin. It's a sin sacrifice, a sin offering. He in innocence became the sin offering
that we may be made the righteousness of God in him. Now being cut off from sin.
Eh? He who bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we now being cut off from sin, dead to sin, should live unto righteousness.
By whose wounds we were healed.
Oh, mama, I tell you, I just want you to live and dwell and abide in this, because this is what the Holy Ghost is ministering. That's why there's no condemnation. See, in Romans chapter 8, when we talk about when he uses the word the realm flesh, he's talking about the unredeemed men. Unredeemed man. Sometimes Paul uses flesh like in Galatians, referring to human ability. Ishmael was born after the flesh. It's human ability. Also, Peter uses flesh in a different way. Jesus was manifested in the flesh. That's human existence. Eh? Are you with me? So it's very important for us to understand these various different shades of meaning and these words that we grapple with. And it's so simple to understand when you just begin to define everything in Christ Jesus, everything in the new creation, everything in the born-again experience, everything in the fact that God lives and dwells in you, the temple of the Holy Ghost. Then all of a sudden, all these other abstract notions and concepts of where people wrestle the scripture to their own destruction because they try to define God's word. They redefine God's word based upon their own human experience. Stop it! You're not going to get anywhere with God that way. Because you take God's word and you mix it with your word and you got a lie. I'm going to put it this way. Maybe it'll make you feel better about yourself. Take God's word, mix it with your word, and you don't have the truth no more. We have to accept what God has said. For the law of the spirit of life. There's a life-giving spirit. Paul said in Galatians chapter 3, he said, if there would have been a law that could have imparted life, then righteousness would have been by the law, Galatians 3:21. But the law could not impart life. It could only show man how different, how other, how alien men did in their trespasses and sins are from God. But Christ Jesus came and imparted life by the Holy Ghost. Woo! The law of the spirit of life. You could say spiritual laws of life, but the law of the Holy Ghost. The life-giving laws of the Holy Ghost that are in Christ Jesus has made us free from the law of sin and death. The law of sin cannot govern me. The law of sin that says you must demand, you must obey my lust. There's nothing you can do about my lust. Oh, we're all born this way. We all have these various different needs and issues. No. You put to death anything unlike God. You set a boundary on your life and say, if anything crosses this boundary, it will be thrust through with a dart. It shall be stoned and burned and buried. Kill it 4 times. That's kind of how I deal with snakes, man. I'm telling you right now. I smash them, then I cut their head off, and then I bury them. Because I don't want the dogs chewing on it. And fangs still have venom in it. Huh? People would rather basically read in the Romans some dual nature, some part of their being still belonging to Satan, while God's got 2/3, Satan's got 1/3, or half and half, or however it is. People divided up. No, we are liberated. We are free. Where all that matters to you is living out this wonderful heavenly realm of living in that which the holy angels, the seraphims, having behold, all they can do is shout and go, ah, hold on. Not holy, holy, holy. It's far more than that. Just get in the present for a minute and you'll begin to understand. It begins to elicit every dimension of human passion and emotion. And it raptures you away with such awesome display of that which goes beyond any majestic thing that you've ever seen or experienced in here. I'm telling you, his presence is an amazing, glorious, full of fullness of life.
is full ecstasy of joy. When the Lord talks about what he's going to give us in reward, he's going to say, enter into the fullness of my joy. Come on into the joy.
Woo!
Anybody who's ever lived here knows that it's the truth. Anybody who's ever been caught away in the wind of the presence of God, in the wind of the Spirit, in the blast of divine glory, they know that it's ecstasy of joy unspeakable. They understand that it is a thrill that surpasses anything that can be given in the realms of men or brought to pass in the realms of the demonic. Satan knows it. Satan knows it. He knows he cannot hold a candle to the pleasures that are at the right hand. He knows that there's no way he could begin to influence men should they touch this realm of divine glory that has been given to them. So he tries to, and soon as somebody calls upon the name of Jesus, he sets a snare called religion. He sets a snare that is purely based upon philosophy and tradition. Spoils men after the rudiments of the world and not after Christ Jesus. God wants to fashion us. He's fashioned us after Christ Jesus, the heavenly man, the one from heaven. Hallelujah. The one that said, Father, give me the glory that I had with you before there was ever anything. Hallelujah. Somebody said, well, you're not practical, you're not real, you're fantastical, you're extreme. You're an extremist with an extreme point of view. You're not dealing with the things that we have to deal with on a daily basis. Oh, yeah, I am. I'm telling you, you walk in the Holy Ghost and you will not want any of the things that have been getting after you on a daily basis. You will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. You walk in the Spirit. You be filled with the Spirit. I'm telling you right now, those things will not have its hold on you anymore. Hallelujah. You'll find a divine power that's greater than sickness and disease and sin and temptation and iniquity. All men have known is the pleasures that they derive from the sewage. The sewage of darkness and demonic influence. Small-minded thinking, barely above the mentality of the cattle. Who live to eat and reproduce. God has made us heavenly creatures.
Hallelujah.
Fashioned in his image and his likeness. Hallelujah. Filled with his divine power and with his divine glory. Walking in the Holy Ghost. You're going to be taught all the realms of his life. It's an abundant life. It's a life of complete liberty and authority. What does that mean? You're not under the tyranny of a taskmaster anymore. Satan cannot put anything on you. You belong to God. You're in his bosom. Papa loves the hugs and the kisses. He does. Jesus showed us that in Simeon's house. Simeon, you gave me no oil. You gave me no kisses. This woman has been continually kissing my feet since you. I tell you right now, I'd like to see church become as it was in those days. Give me a bunch of people who finally have been touched by the Master, who come to surrender to his love. Because the bottom line of it is a glorious display of affection towards him. He that is forgiven much. All I can say is that I just came to a revelation that I was forgiven much. Thus I love much. But he that is forgiven little loveth little. And you know what that says to me? Jesus says, he that is forgiven little loveth little and has a little display of it.
So you decide what category you're in. You know? You is me here.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah.
For what the law could not do, and that it was weak because of the unredeemed condition of men, the unredeemed state of men, the inability of human beings who were born in iniquity and shaped in sin, who lived under the yoke of the transgression of Adam, who lived under the condemnation of a death sentence because sin passed upon all men because of what Adam did. So that therefore now we come to all men have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And that's the, you know, Paul's already laid these things out in Romans 3 and Romans chapter 5, and you can't forget that. And so when you begin to try to understand what's being said, you have to understand it in light of what God's already declared and established here. He says, for what the law could not do, and that it was weakened through the flesh or the sinful, unredeemed state of men, God sending his Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin. And because of sin, he condemned sin in the flesh. What did he do? He said, it doesn't exist here. It's not to exist here. And then he condemned sin in the flesh, having been put to death, having been made a curse for us, having borne in his own body all our death sentences, so that now we might be alive in him through the resurrection. Because without the resurrection, we're still lost in our sins and our faith is vain. Raised up together with him. People are just talking about it. See, it comes right out of their mouth. Oh, I'm dying. Yeah, you're just dying. Go ahead and die. So that you can be raised up with him and now have a new life. And it won't be so hard anymore. Here people are talking, oh, I just die and I'm dying daily. The total misapplication of one verse of scripture when Paul was talking about the decay of his mortal body and trying to give a definition and interpretation at the expense of contradicting hundreds of verses of scripture. I'll tell you right now, God's raised up people like me to ruin all that mess. We're going to ruin it. And it's not by human ability. And it's not just by God has chosen the foolishness of preaching to confound the wise. God's chosen the foolishness of preaching to display his power. He's going to do it in a mighty way by the Spirit of the Lord who breathes on the word. See, it's the Holy Spirit who makes the word living. Huh? The Holy Ghost shall overshadow you. The power of the Most High shall overshadow you, and that whole thing shall be conceived on the inside of you, shall be of the Holy Ghost. He made the Holy Ghost made the Word, the living Word, to be incarnated and live among us, to be revealed and shown to us. You know what many people are doing with their children? They're teaching their children how to lust after things with toys and everything that had constantly entertained them to keep them occupied in the electronic state of the electronic age. Oh, just quiet them down, keep them occupied. Teaching them how to live after a human existence, after a human stimulation, rather than understanding how to touch the realms of the Holy Ghost. Somebody said, how do you teach people how to move in the realms of the Holy Ghost? You got to start moving in the realms of the Holy Ghost yourself first. And then it's what we call a divine contagion. It is a divine contagion. Theologians understand what I'm talking about because that's what we call that glory that is there in the holies of holies. Huh? The divine contagion. You touch the holy things and you got holy all over you. Hallelujah. You can't allow yourself to get an unclean state. And you have, because your garments have been infected in a glorious way by the holy and divine contagion. You got to take off your garments there at the temple and not allow them to be mingled with things that are earthly. I'm going to live here. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm going to live baptized to this realm. I'm more to sing a die. You know, one day I was asking the Lord, I was praying for a miracle, and the miracle didn't happen. I was asking the Lord about it. I said, Lord, why did this miracle happen, that miracle happen, but this other miracle didn't happen? He said, you need to pray in the Holy Ghost more. We need to give ourselves to being built up in the realms of the Spirit. Some people have faith for headaches. God wants you to have faith for everything. Some people have faith to raise people from the dead and can't see somebody get healed of a headache. I mean, come, Father wants every display of the power of his glory to be in our life. And he doesn't want to be in a limited fashion. You pray for one person, and one person in your lifetime of your walking with the Lord has been healed. not the fullness of the measure of the maturity of the ministry of Jesus. You prayed for one person that was demon-possessed 5 years ago, and after walking with God for 40 years, you got one person, you saw one person delivered. And you're happy with that? You're going to boast on that? I wouldn't tell anyone. I just keep it to myself. Say, I'm reaching. I'm pressing in. I'm taking a hold of God. I just want to move out of the unbelief and start moving in the realms of faith. I want to start moving in the realms of spirit. Come on, people. You just got to start doing these things.
God has ordained it. He's fashioned us to do it. I want you to turn this thing up. It's like I have to keep getting the microphone closer and closer to my mouth.
It's almost about to be inserted now.
Hallelujah. Mom, Dad, God, I say, that's too much. And everybody, all the people out there in television land are having to now adjust their deals. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Why would you choose to be sad when God will fill you with joy if you'll participate? Somebody said, how do I do that? Begin to give yourself to the Holy Ghost. Begin to yield to Him. Because you're going to yield to the frustration. You're going to come under the influence of earthly mandates, earthly dictates, earthly direction, earthly interest. And God says, no. You're not walking in the Holy Ghost there. You're not living by the Holy Ghost there. It's time for you to come over here and be filled with the Spirit. What does that look like? Same way it looked like when it first began. Just like it looked like on the day of Pentecost. Nothing's changed here. Same Holy Ghost. Same work of divine grace. Same outworking. Can be continually filled, to be continually baptized, to be continually immersed, to be continually under His leadership, to be continually under His direction. And so, I mean, Paul's really laying it out here as he says in verse 4, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us. What did the righteousness of the law declare? Declared God's righteousness. But now the righteousness of God is manifested not just being witnessed by the law and the prophets, but now being revealed and manifested through our life, even the righteousness which is by Christ Jesus, that is given to us, that we've all been filled up with, because we've had unlimited supply of what? His life. We were crucified with Christ. We were buried with Him by baptism into His death. And now we're raised up together with Him and alive together with Him and seated in the heavenly realm. Why on earth would anybody want to go back and die again? That's not even logical. That has no logic. That's nothing. There's nothing logical about that. Oh, I've been crucified with Christ. I'm buried with Him by baptism and death. I've been raised up together with Him. I'm alive together with Him. I'm seated in heavenly places, and now I'm going to go die. And I'm dying. Why are you dying? What are you dying to? No, put to death anything. You don't allow to exist anything in your life that is contrary to the ways of God, because God's given you an authority, and He's given you dominion, and He's given you power by the Holy Ghost to be able to do this, by the Holy Spirit, who gives you insight and understanding and a desire. He gives you a craving for righteousness and a despising and hatred of iniquity. He teaches us these things. We grow in Him. We're learning obedience. Jesus learned obedience through the things which He suffered. That is an amazing thing. He had a diet of butter and honey that He may learn to choose the good and refuse the evil. We're learning. We better be learning, because some people aren't learning. It doesn't seem like if they are learning, that is a one slow step process that I can't tell whether the line has moved. It ought to be a straight up, man. It ought to be some point where it just goes straight through the ceiling. God made it that way. Jesus said, it's expedient for you that I go away. I'm going to give you the expedited plan. I'm going to put you on the fast track. Hallelujah. I'm going to send you the Holy Ghost. It's good that I go. Everybody's sad. He said, no, don't be sad. It's good that I'm going. You don't understand it. It's good I'm going. You're getting ready to have yourself one amazing Holy Ghost heavenly event. You're going to be so happy. Just wait. Just wait. He's going to come. He's going to reveal me in a way that you can't see me right now. I have many things to tell you, but you can't bear them. You can't receive them. There's got to be a major shift, a major change, a major insight, a major revelation, a major working of the divine power of God that is only possible because all of a sudden the glory of heaven comes upon you, and now you're not ruled by your own appetites, your own emotions, your own passions, your own whims and wishes. anymore. You're overwhelmed by the glory of heaven. Hallelujah. Does doubt come out to battle against that? Sure. What are you going to do? You're going to just begin to rejoice in God, hold fast to His Word. I mean, I'll just always say, as soon as the legions of doubt begin to line up against me to form an attack, I just begin to say, well, watch what God will do. Yeah. Hallelujah. I don't worry. You know what? I've been converted. I'm like a little child. Bills aren't my responsibility. Not my issue. Belongs to God. Hallelujah. And it's active faith. It's active faith. It's not passive faith. It's active faith. And so when you've got active faith, I'm going to tell you right now, all that you have need of will be met. Amen. He'll supply all that you have need of according to His riches and glory. And that begins first with the spiritual dimensions, not the physical or earthly dimensions or financial dimensions. I pray, God, that you prosper and be in health even as your soul are in direct proportion to soul prosperity. People want to have it. They want to have their health and their physical stuff first. And then, listen, I ain't going to do anything for you. Health and riches hasn't brought anybody to submission to God and obedience to God. God, the Holy Ghost, has brought us to obedience and submission to God. It's about time we learn how to let God, the Holy Ghost, live. It's about time we learn how to let God, the Holy Ghost, be in charge. It's about time we learn how to walk in His direction instead of walking under human influence. Because I'm telling you right now, you either walk in under human influence and you allow that human influence to be fortified in your members, in your thinking, in your activities, or you're walking under the direction of the Holy Ghost and allowing the Spirit of the Lord to fortify you and strengthen you and build you up. I'm talking about build. Make you strong, produce in your life all that God ever purposed when He shaped man in His image and His likeness from the fine dust of the earth and has placed under his dominion all that He had created. And now has restored in us beyond that place in Christ Jesus. Because now we not functioning under the leadership or the headship of an earthly creation, but the eternal God. You hear me?
Yeah.
Well, you had to think about that. We'll talk about that later. There is a realm in God that you're going to have to be willing to first and fundamentally just deal with your fears. You're going to have to start saying no to fear. How are you going to say no to fear? By the Spirit of the Son. How is the Spirit of the Son going to be allowed to operate? Is He going to force Himself on you? No, you have to yield your members to Him. You've got to actively in a loving relationship because God doesn't have it any other way. People talk about a theocracy or a divine dictatorship. It's not. God rules by relationship. If you love me, you'll obey me. Isn't that beautiful? There's no human model for it. If you love me, you'll obey me. And I'm going to give you the love so that you can love me. And I'm going to give you the spirit of obedience so you can obey me. Hallelujah. I'm going to lead you in a way. Hallelujah. Even the foolish man, the idiot, cannot err there. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
That's what the Lord said. I lead you in the way.
Yeah.
That even the foolish cannot err there. You just simply begin to let God, the Holy Ghost, have His place, which means to wait upon the Lord, to let Him lead. You will not weary. You will not faint. The young men shall weary, but you will not weary. You shall run and not be weary. You shall walk and not faint. You rise up. You'll mount up. Oh, just simply because you give the Holy Ghost first place. You say, okay, Holy Spirit, good morning, Holy Ghost. I never say good night. I say, Lord, empower me, quicken me in my dreams. Come manifest yourself to me. Come reveal to me your glory in a way that I couldn't comprehend. If I was awake, God sometimes can do more when people are asleep. Hallelujah. I wouldn't allow my kids to have anything like crackers or juice or whatever in the meeting. I don't want, you know, them having any of that stuff going on, or toys or crayons or what. But I didn't mind them going to sleep. They didn't lay down and go to sleep. I'll tell you right now, their little spirit, well, their spirit, a child's spirit, a baby's spirit, is big as an adult's spirit. Huh? Are you listening to me?
Yes.
And it just whenever that individual begins to participate with the Holy Ghost and yield to the Holy Ghost, whatever age of accountability. There's some people that are 60. I don't know if they're at the age of accountability yet. You know what I'm saying? I haven't seen her start really participating with God yet. Not on a full-time scale. I mean, they're like, you know, in 3-4 hours a week. That's in church. That's somebody spoon-feeding them with a little, you know, bib on, the whole works. I'm provoking you to good works. And don't be too offended. I'm actually talking to a broader audience by the Holy Ghost. Yes. Praise God for the people who give themselves to the web and to the YouTube so that we're able to touch as many people as we do. It's amazing how many people watch the web and watch the YouTube. Praise God for it. I mean, I get so blessed on Monday morning when I got people on Twitter tweeting Sunday morning service, you know. I don't even know who they are. Watch this, and it's a link, and I go, wow, okay, whoa, that's, whoa, praise God. This is what the Holy Ghost has to say. God to Kanameyashia. He that hears us hears God. Can you say that? Yeah, because I'm in the same church that John's in. I'm under the same Holy Ghost mandate that the one who God inspired to use to say those words, which was the Apostle John. They that hear us hear God. They that do not hear us do not hear God. If you're speaking by the Spirit, okay, and people won't listen to you, then they're not listening to God. Is that pretty simple to understand? And when we come to a place where we don't trust in ourselves, but we trust in the teacher who's come to lead us and guide us, and we know that he's going to speak through us with revelation, with knowledge, with doctrine, with prophecy. And doctrine's not something that you distill because you're able to do word searches with Strong's Exhaustive Concordance or your computer program. It's something that God the Holy Ghost gives to you because you begin to yield to him and you begin to talk to him in the realms that he has provided for us to speak in the realms of the heavenly. I mean, you need to learn the heavenly language so you can talk and communicate properly. You know what I'm saying? He speaks in unknown language, speaks not unto men but unto God. He's speaking mysteries in the Spirit. Learn how to talk properly. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. When you start off as a child, you goo goo gaga. I was trying to help Naomi with the whole concept of mama, dada. Then I went on to papa, which is me. Mimi, she's getting confused. But she's going to get it. She's going to get it. Yesterday, the other night, she was just having a great time walking to me and then turn around and walking back to her mama and then turn around and walking back to me. This is a great, man, what a trick. What a skill set. I'm walking now. I mean, this is a breakthrough. It's a moment. It's a milestone. It is a great moment in time. She's walking on Father's earth. Listen, dear people, we're going to have all kinds of patience with you, but we're going to have a problem when you're crawling around and you're 20 years old. We're going to be a bit embarrassed. I'm not embarrassed of the Holy Ghost, but I might be embarrassed with you crawling around at 20. We might keep you in the back room, but we're going to bring the Holy Ghost out in the front room. He's going to be in the main sanctuary. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And we're going to send somebody back there to work with you. Amen. Because we don't want anybody thinking this is what the results of what it means to be in God for 20 years. You'll be still crawling around. Still full of doubt and unbelief. Still worry and living under the domination of fear. Satan does most everything that he does through fear. He creates intimidation, self-consciousness. Self-consciousness is the wildest thing. It is something that literally creates an atmosphere, whether you recognize it or not. And it can happen. It happens a lot in the midst of the church. It's just a function of fear. It's intimidation. It's time that you no longer yield yourself to fear, that you understand by the authority of the Holy Ghost now that you can now have a love in relationship with God, be so filled up with love that casts out all fear, that you have such boldness that nothing, you laugh at death. Amen.
Amen.
Death says he's coming to take you and you say, you ain't do nothing. You have no power over me. Father alone has power. He decides. I'm coming when he calls me. Jesus is personally going to come and get me. You can believe whatever it is you want to be, believe. But he said in his word, I shall come again and receive you unto myself. And everybody wants you to keep that in a catching way. I got that right now for me. He's coming after me. Hallelujah. Dake, who did the Dake Bible, has been very influential in our lives. And And my mother grew up with his daughter, Finette. And some of the closest people to us have been also integrated with that family for a long, long time. And so this just the influence in our life is we've been blessed by what God did through Finest Jennings Dake. And I believe he was 84 or 85, I can't remember, and Philip and Finette and family wanted to take him to the hospital because he wasn't doing well. He said, "Are you kidding me? Look out on the front lawn." They said, "What, Dad?" He said, "The chariot of the Lord is here. The angels are standing out there waiting to take me. I'm not moving. I'm staying right here." He sat there. That's a whole lot better than being hooked up by a bunch of IVs. People run around, whatever. Giving you all these drugs and medication. You hallucinate. Don't know whether you're alive or dead. Don't know whether you're awake or dreaming. Who wants to live or die like that? Hallelujah. I can just tell you right now, I won't be dying in no hospital. Hallelujah. Yeah. And I won't be dying in no pain. Why? Because I've given myself right now to living in Christ Jesus, living in this wonderful realm of divine health, of divine provision, of divine healing, of divine working power. I'm not under the law of sin and death. I'm living in the life of Christ Jesus, supplied to me by the Holy Ghost, whom I'm yielding continually my members to. Hallelujah. And he makes it so physical. He makes it so practical. He makes it so real. He makes it so overwhelming. He makes it so living. People look at me like I'm just trying to come up with something nice to say when I say, give yourself to the manifest presence of the Lord and his manifest presence would get stronger. Well, if people would really believe that, you would do that all the time. Because there's nothing like his manifest glory. You just want to have a religious switch. Okay, God, it's your turn. Okay, you're done. We're giving you 2 hours on Sunday morning. That's a cutting edge church. You're not going to get out of here in 2 hours. I don't know how to preach like that. I don't know how to minister. I don't know how to even get moving in the things of God like that. My examples are people like Paul who preached till late in the night and somebody fell out of the second story window late and fell asleep and fell down dead. They went, raised him from the dead, and continued on preaching till the morning. Then after that, they parted to the next town. All night meetings. I know you need your sleep, especially those of you who have not learned how to let the Spirit of the Lord have more impact on you than your physical body. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Huh? All your needs. I got to have 12 hours of sleep. I'm going to exaggerate a little bit, okay? I don't think anybody needs 12 hours of sleep, but I felt the other day like I needed 12 hours of sleep. I've been so sleep deprived, but I need, however many hours of sleep it is that you need. Like, I don't know how many it is. For me, it seems like people are talking 12. They want to be out of church by 8 in the morning. I mean, by 8 at night, rather. You want to be out of church by 8 or 9? How late are you sleeping, man? What time do you got to get up? 3? You know what I'm saying? That's already 7 hours or so. But nonetheless, I guess they got to have an hour to get home and buffet their body or whatever it is they got to do. Because everybody's got their agendas. And we got God on a time clock. We've got him split into a little space in our life. He needs to become our whole existence. I don't have anything else to do. Holy Ghost, I'm here to be able to. I watch people get up and walk out of the church all the time. They're the masters of their own life. You can't tell me that God's first and they're submitting themselves to God and to his and what it is he wants to do because he's doing what it is he wants to do right here. And they need every second of it. And the meeting will be over when Father concludes that you need going home, get some rest. When he has done everything he possibly can do to reach into everyone's heart, mind, and thinking to bring as many as he possibly can to complete and total surrender so that he can go ahead and bless you. That's all God's doing. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, there was one time I was saying, Lord, can I please be like you? Lord, can I please? And what I was saying, I was looking at a couple of people. I wanted to tackle them. Like he did Jacob. Lord, may I please? I want to rush on that person. I want to throw them to the ground. I guarantee you, I don't care how big you are. If you're sitting there and I come running at you full speed, you're going down. You're going down hard. It's just the way it is. It's an issue of momentum. Hallelujah. May I please, Father. And the Lord has restrained me. And help me understand that he does that and I'm not allowed to do that. I want to get people in Holy Ghost headlocks all the time. Saying, please. But all that is the arm of human ability, the arm of flesh. But I'm earnest, I'm passionate about it. You know that Lord desires passion of the deepest sort? On the level of how, you know how you feel when you get real thirsty? You know how you feel when you get real hungry? Can't think about anything else. Cannot think about it. You know what? When you get real thirsty, nothing else even matters. You don't even have lust of the flesh no more. I tell you right now, you don't even have the lust of the eye anymore. It doesn't exist. Pride of life doesn't exist. You're just like, I gotta have something to drink. I gotta have something to drink. I'm gonna die unless I get something to drink. It's truth. You know, I'm telling you, there is nothing else that even exists. Nothing. There is no other influence. There is a heavenly realm that will impact you even greater than that earthly realm. That earthly need is something so small in comparison to a heavenly need that the Holy Ghost will activate in you if you will participate with him. It will mature. It will grow. It will become a dominating force in your life. Not an influence, a force. I said a force. The mighty ways to see, we're probably going to have an El Nino this year like we had in 81 because of the big, you know, all the things, all the signs, the crab dump and all the other signs that are going on. There's going to be huge waves. The mighty ways of the sea, they are not an influence. They are force. Father, touch David, those boys. Touch that family. I pray, Father, in Jesus' name. Arrest that whole family. I pray, Father, in Jesus' name. Arrest them with your glory. I'm tired of seeing Satan take advantage of people's lives. You're just going to have to get yourself a Holy Ghost spine. You have to get yourself some Holy Ghost might, some Holy Ghost determination. He had to supply a determination that will not give the realms of death and darkness and sin one inch. He give you a heavenly understanding and a heavenly mind. You won't be small-minded anymore. For me, small-mindedness is not about vision. It's about interest. It's about interest. I pray that your interests are in heaven. That's not small-minded. I pray that your interests are in those things which God, the Holy Ghost, has come to teach us. That's beautiful. That goes beyond anything, any skill set, anything that you may learn in the halls of men's understanding. The scripture goes on to say that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us. How? Who walk after the Holy Ghost. Somebody says, I don't even understand. How can you even say that the righteousness of the law? The law revealed the righteousness of God. The law revealed, the law displayed everything that Father purposed for man to be. The law declared his holiness. The law declared his righteousness, his purity. And now he's saying that we might fulfill the righteousness which is of the law. How? Only by one means. Who walk in the Holy Ghost. So what is the Holy Ghost doing? He's keeping us in a place where we have no condemnation, where we have no conscience of sin, no sense of separation. He's teaching us 100% oneness and union with God. If you don't have oneness and union with God, you've got a sense of separation. That's condemnation. God, the Holy Ghost is administering that. If you walk in the Holy Ghost, you won't have to deal with that stuff no more. Is it going to be a battle? Yeah, it's going to be a battle. Somebody says, what have I got to do if I'm dealing with condemnation? What must I do if I'm dealing with a sense of shame and guilt and Satan's bringing up the past and I'm having to deal with things, memories of the past? You know, one of the things that people don't talk about that needs to be talked about a whole lot more is the fact that every one of us have the knowledge of good and evil. It's not a sin nature that we have after having been redeemed. It's the knowledge of good and evil. That's a powerful force to reckon with. And the only way that we can even begin to deal with the knowledge of good and evil, to love righteousness and hate iniquity, to love the good and refuse and hate the evil, is to be taught by the Holy Ghost, to have the same diet that Jesus had, the diet of the Word and the diet of the Spirit, the things of that God would minister to us and teach. And when you're having to deal with these things that would try to come against you and condemn you and separate you and make you feel other than God, you have to pray in the Holy Ghost. You're going to have to give yourself. You're going to have to yield your members to righteousness. What does that mean? You yield your members to the Holy Ghost. How are you going to walk in the righteousness of God? By the Holy Ghost. Then go ahead and yield to the Holy Ghost. Let Him begin to be the influence in the thinking. Let Him begin to be the influence in the feeling. Let Him begin to be the force in the thinking and in the feeling and in the emotions. How? It's like if you're not... functioning in the realms of joy, isn't that something that is so obvious? Pray in the Holy Ghost till the joy comes. Do you do that? And sometimes I wonder how many people do that, because I'm telling you right now, you don't do that for very long and you're walking around in joy, in greater joy. And if I don't see a measurable increase in joy in your life, I don't believe you're doing that. Or you may believe you're doing it, but it's not going anywhere, because the manifestation of the Holy Ghost is supposed to excel. Tongues are supposed to excel into other displays of the gifts of the Spirit and the fruits of the Spirit, into every dimension of the things that God the Holy Ghost brings to us. And I watch where people are just stuck. I watch them walk around almost emotionless, almost faceless, I mean, with no expression, and they're just praying. And it's about that. I think that actually sounds better. Because it's like an obnoxious noise. It's like a tinkling cymbal and a sound of brass. And it's like, hey, would you please quit doing that? Is it truth in the inward parts? Is it the flow of the Holy Ghost, or is it a religious exercise? I mean, when we get serious for truth, when we're hungry for truth, God demands truth in the inward parts, and the hidden parts. He should cause us to know wisdom. When we begin to cry out for Him with this needy, thirsty desire, I mean, Isaiah really makes it big when he talks about the promise of the Father. When Paul or Peter refers to the promise of the Father, Jesus refers to the promise of the Father, the promise of the Spirit. When we dial back and we look at that promise as it was described, for example, by Isaiah, Isaiah says, when you're like a thirsty man in the desert where there is no water and you failing, in other words, you're dying, your kidneys are failing, your legs are swelling up from inflammation of kidney failure, your tongue swollen in your mouth, now you ask for water, the Lord will open up heaven and pour out water. And it's just not like that you're having to be in a state of begging God. It's that the Lord will produce an extreme neediness for the reality of heaven in our life. So many people just want to have expressions and things going on in their life so that they can get the approval of men. I'm doing good now, right? But that's not what that's about. You want Father's approval. You want that with that flow from heaven. You basically, there is a realm of walking with God where everybody else disappears and only Father's there. Based upon a machia senatia. Mambrodane estekite baladopatoya. Berestekina mapatea, bunkoshigala matea. Borest aneste. Borest aneste. Borest aneste. Berena. What am I doing now? I'm worshiping. I'm having worship service pretty much. Balamansadera de Benakaya. Hallelujah. I'm London Mantokoriama. I'm talking to the Father. Risiperenekia and the Basadoro. Staha. Hallelujah. I'm yielding myself in another dimension to the Holy Ghost, so I know what next to say. I know what next to do. It's something you want to begin to do so that you now can begin to receive that which Father is declaring. That God wants to activate on something on the inside of you with His Word and by His Spirit. And by the expressions of the Holy Ghost. The more you give yourself to participating with the Holy Ghost, the more you yield yourself to Him, the easier it is. The more you spend time with Him, the easier it is to recognize His movings, to be overwhelmed, knocked down by His movings. The less you do that, the more you get involved in religion, the more you resist the Holy Ghost. Paul says, you as your fathers do always resist the Holy Ghost. Where the ministry of Jesus would raise people from the dead, cause the blind to see, cause those who had no arms for them to grow out, maimed from leprosy, have new body parts, the Pharisees stood there and said, He's the devil. Having no sensitivity whatsoever to the movings of the Spirit of the Lord. I want you to understand, you need to give yourself to this kind of working of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. That begins at Pentecost, because if you don't have Pentecost, you can't have this. Somebody said, well, let's start talking theological terms. I mean, you know, you don't have to be baptized in the Holy Ghost to be saved. No, but if you're saved, you're going to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. Because there's no concept or expression in the Bible about people just being left with Jesus' earthly ministry and not having His heavenly ministry too. What sense does that make? His earthly ministry was all given so that we could have His heavenly ministry. He talked about what He was going to accomplish for us once He was glorified. He talked about in the future tense, I'm getting ready to give you something. Come and drink it out of your bowel, out of your innermost. It wasn't available when He said it. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Wasn't available. He declared, He prophesied, if any man thirst, come. And I will give you to drink. And out of, as the scripture says, out of your innermost being, literally, out of your kolia, or from an Attic Greek point of view, out of your depths of your passions and emotions. Ooh, does that smack heresy in the face? Right out of your passions and your emotions, out of your kolia. The Lord used that word specifically for a reason. Out of your passions and your emotions. Out of your kolia shall flow rivers of living water. This spake He of the Holy Ghost. Parenthetical statement. This spake He of the Holy Ghost, which was not yet given, for He was not yet glorified. So if you're going to have the expressions of God's glory in God's life that are on the scale of rivers, how are you going to do that? You're going to have to understand how to yield your members to the Holy Ghost as instruments of righteousness. You got to understand how to stop yielding yourself and your members and your life and your thinking and your emotions and your passions to other things that will shut that down. Fear is going to shut down love. Doubt's going to shut down faith. Earthly interests are going to shut down heavenly interests. Carnal thinking, carnal living is going to shut down the working and operation of the Holy Ghost. It's literally going to shut you down from being able to receive what God has freely given. You only way that you and I can receive what God has freely given is by functioning in the Holy Ghost. I'm getting ready to read that to you. I'm just setting you up for it. You ready? Yeah. For they that are in the flesh do mind the things of the flesh. They that are in an unredeemed state are mind the things of an unredeemed person. You could say that you could even actually then go ahead and apply this in terms of self-interest and expectation of change to human ability. But I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to leave it to the unredeemed state. Because they that are born of the flesh are what? What did Jesus say? This is Paul's amplification on what Jesus said. They that are born of the flesh are flesh. They that are born of the spirit are spirit. This is Paul by the Holy Ghost, helping us to more fully understand what Jesus said in John 3:3-6. Just a few verses of scripture. Now the Holy Ghost is expanding it for us so that we make more clearly understand what it is that God would have us do. This isn't for educational purposes only, for information purposes only. It isn't for you to sit here tonight and say, wow, it was a good meeting, the presence of the Lord was there. It's for you to change and start doing it. For you to do it. It's for you to come to complete and total reliance, not being independent, but relying fully upon God. You can't do anything without Him. To recognize you have been given an anointing, and the anointing does what? You've given a special kind of an anointing, and it is an anointing to have the ability and the understanding and the insight to continually live in Christ Jesus, to dwell in Him. A divine ability to dwell. God gave the priest, the high priest, a divine anointing, a divine ability to enter into the holies of holies. He's given you and I a divine ability and anointing to live and dwell in Jesus. It affects every dimension of our life, our understanding, our thinking, our passions, our emotions, our appetite. It affects everything. Will things interest earthly interest? Human passions press against their soul. Yeah, but no worries. Will the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, all that is in the world, the pride of life, press strong against our soul? Yeah, but no worries. Greater is He that is in us than He is in the world. If you know how to be strengthened by the Spirit, if you know how to be strengthened by the Holy Ghost in your inner being, if you don't, you're going to be overrun. Listen to me. Samson could do what he did because the Spirit of the Lord came upon him and gave him strength, power, ability, supernatural ability. God, the Holy Ghost, lives and dwells in us and is there ready to supply to us supernatural ability, but it is not passive, it is active. It is a permission, as it were, of our will, saying, God, you may come and help me. Arise, O God, that my enemies may be scattered. Go before me, that my enemies may fall and be defeated. I know He delights in me, hallelujah, because my enemy cannot triumph over me. Does your enemy triumph over you? It's certainly not Father's will. The Lord goes on and says, for they that are in the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are of in the Holy Ghost, or they that are after the Holy Ghost, been born of the Holy Ghost, you're supposed to be minding the things of the Holy Ghost. So, Holy Ghost, what are you doing? Well, Holy Ghost, you're doing joy. Well, I'm not going to do sorrow. I don't care how much sorrow is pressing up against me. I don't care the atmosphere that some demon spirit is creating. I'm not yielding myself to it. I'm going to mind the things of the Holy Ghost. I'm not going to capitulate and just be overwhelmed with some fear because somebody said I got cancer or whatever, or some sickness or disease. I'm going to rise up and cast it out. I love the story of when Smith Wigglesworth was laying dying of appendicitis. And the doctor went up and said that he was already in an advanced stage of that terrible eruption of the appendix. He said to come down the stairs, said to his wife, said, there's nothing I can do. All you can do is just make him comfortable. Try to make him comfortable. Try. Ease his mind. There's nothing I can do. A preacher walked in, didn't talk to the wife, nothing, ran straight upstairs, jumped on Smith, and before Smith could tell him what was going on to try to explain medically the issue, he cast the devil out of him. And Smith was completely healed. Well, that just doesn't fit into our theology. But it works. It brought the results that no one else could get. You foul spirit of hell, I command you to go. No, it's just an erupted appendix. No, it's a demon and I'm casting it out right now. But our medical intuition and our monitors and our meters and our propellers told us that it was this, and we know that if we take a knife and cut you open, oh my, that we can fix this issue and give you a bunch of antibiotics. We're not going to talk too much about the pharmacopoeia of it all. Hair of toad and eye of newt. Spin 3 times and shake. Now drink this potion. It's amazing how it works. And then we come up with all of our theoretical models. I said to a scientist one time, I said, you got a theoretical model for that? He said, I got a theoretical model for everything. I said, that's right, you do. That's the problem of men. They got a theoretical model for everything. Has nothing, no bearing on reality. But it's a means by which we can explain what's going on. Did you know that one of the primary pillars of evolution and what we call truth is based upon this one premise, that we cannot involve the existence of God as a means to explain natural phenomena. Remove that pillar. I mean, you're going to believe what they said, and that is the primary first pillar of which the house is built upon? We need to go around and educate people, that's all. And say, this is it. It's called the Enlightenment. They call that the Enlightenment. That's about how deceived the world is. This is the Enlightenment. God's not doing it. Erase God from existence. That's Enlightenment. Are you telling me I can't run to the doctor? Go. Take off. Run. Whatever. I'm telling you, not going to develop faith and allow God to develop faith within you for divine healing running to the doctor. I'm going to tell you, it's going to be dependence upon doctor. I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to nurture fear in your life. Obama can say all he wants, I'm not getting medical insurance. Are you going to pay taxes? Fine, I'll pay more money. I don't need a medical insurance. I have assurance, divine assurance. I live in divine health. So you can say, well, you know, you can't impose that on us. I don't want to. I would never impose that on you. It's just, you know, it's just a benefit. For those who believe, I'm going to make you. Oh, are you telling us we're not right with God if we don't believe what you believe? No, I'm just telling you it's a benefit. You can believe this if you want. I'm telling you about divine health. You don't have to die sick, sorry, and in pain. You can live pain-free. You can be in health even as you're, and you can prosper and be in health even as you're so prosperous. Hallelujah. Bodhisattva Pekatisht. You don't need to run over to the lawyer because you think somebody's going to sue you. You got divine protection. Hallelujah. You don't need to defend yourself because God is your defense. Are you going to walk in the Holy Ghost, or are you going to walk after the human ability? Are you going to walk after a former conversation, the unredeemed state, the unredeemed thinking, the unredeemed mind, the unredeemed way of living? Are you going to recognize that you belong to the family of God and Father is fully entrusted to you all that He has? And you can, if all you have to do is believe, and nothing will be impossible for those who believe. Amen.
Yeah. Amen.
That must be false doctrine, someone said. Because I just think that that's just, you know, that's not practical. That sounds like a cult. No, you a cult, man. This is what God said. Father has empowered us with all. He is the author of life. He's liberated us from what? Sin and death. Hallelujah. Ah. And I tell you, sickness and pain and disease fits right nicely into those categories. I'm going to live in divine protection. I'm praying protection over my kids. I'm not having accidents. Amen. Accidents happen because somebody wasn't watching. Hallelujah. I'm going to watch and pray. Amen. I'm going to walk over here in a place of obedience with the Lord. I'm not going to be like a mule. I'm not going to be all muley Christian. Huh? Got to be moved by a bridle and a bit. I'm not going to be a foolish Christian. A rod is for the fool's back. Huh? Do you know Jesus called some of his disciples fools one day? Don't tell me I've been preaching harsh. He said, oh, foolish. Oh, you foolish and slow of heart to believe all that God has spoken by His servants. God has placed the declaration of those things that you said by the servants, the prophets, above what he said by his audible voice. Because that's God's program. It's true. Peter said, I was there in the mount. We saw the excellent glory and heard when the voice came from heaven. Father said, this is my beloved Son, whom I'm well pleased, hear ye him. But we have a more certain word of prophecy. Ooh. Whereunto you do well if you take heed as unto a light shining in a dark place.
Yeah.
The God-breathed word that comes forth from his servants.
Yeah.
With, hallelujah. And he's got servants alive today, and amen, I'm one of them.
Amen.
And I tell you right now, you can define and see his servants real plainly. If they speak according to this word and declaring this word, they're his servants. And if they're not, there's no light in them. They have another spirit. Paul said, if anybody else comes and preaches any other gospel to you than what I preached, let them be accursed. And that curse that come down from the Apostle Paul's mouth is still as active today as it was when he spoke it back in 64 A.D., almost 2,000 years ago. Still just, I'm going to make sure I preach just like Paul. Hallelujah. I'll just study everything he said. Amen. I'm preach just like he preached. And he preached just like Jesus. Amen. I'm not going to add to it or take away from it, because if you add to the book, the reality of it is you open yourself to deception. And if you take away from the book, once again, you open yourself to deception. But if you just do what God says the way he said to do it, the Holy Ghost has come to lead us and to guide us in all truth. There's no deception there. Hallelujah. His word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Hallelujah. I'm going to do exactly what he says. He tells me to refuse any kind of sin in my life. He tells me I have authority over sickness and disease. I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to stand boldly up in that, and I'm going to execute his righteous will. I'm going to declare what God said. I'm not going to bend, and I'm not going to bow, and therefore I will not burn. Or in other words, I will not be affected or afflicted by all the stuff that Satan and circumstance and the law of sin and death would try to pose upon me, because I am free from it, because I'm walking in the Holy Ghost. If you're not walking in the Holy Ghost, you're not free from nothing. You're depending upon your own human ability, and your own human ability is not going to get you any further than anybody else's human ability going to get them. You hear me now? God, the Holy Ghost, is telling us how to live out this life. He hits every single point that we have to confront on a daily basis in a very practical way, and the answer is always the same. Walk in the Holy Ghost. Rely on the Holy Ghost. Yield to the Holy Ghost. I mean, that's the message. He takes every point that you've got to deal with in life. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
He says to us, he says, they that are after the Holy Ghost do give mind the things of the Holy Ghost, give themselves to the Holy Ghost. For the carnal mind, that could be carnally minded or to be earthly minded, okay, to be minded after the fashion of that which is just purely earthly. What we're going to eat? Oh, we can't be in church too late tonight, because otherwise we can't. Got to get up and go to work early in the morning. And you know, if we don't get to work on time, we might not get that raise. And who knows, we might get fired. I think the boss doesn't like me anyway. I think I'm already on the bubble. And we prophesy over the bad thing. And we're blaming all on God. I get out of church in time. He used to tell me, you know, you keep your kids in church so late. And then somebody was saying they were going to call a child protection services on me for child abuse, because my kids were in church. People ask me all the time, they say, how is it that your kids turned out all so full of the Holy Ghost, all of them ministering by the Spirit? How is, what is it you did? Are you ready? You got your pen out? Yeah, are you ready? I kept them in the Holy Ghost meetings. My wife and I modeled flowing in the Holy Ghost. We were on the same page. They saw mama flowing in the Holy Ghost. They saw daddy flowing in the Holy Ghost. And children will learn more from mom and dad, because I'm going to tell you right now, you create after your own kind. You don't like something in children, you're just looking at yourself. That's some seed you sowed. I'm going to put right squarely where the responsibility right squarely where it belongs. I know people get all upset. Oh, yeah, I can't believe it. I'm not going back there anymore. And I really say that for the benefit more Number one, if you've already raised your children, your chances is over. However, you can influence your children and their children's children. Say, don't be stupid like me. Somebody said, can you please dial that down a little bit? Could you find another, modify those words and make them more palatable? Not really. I can't. Not right now. Save me later. I'm just going with it. Because as far as I'm concerned, without him, we can do nothing. We're ignorant without him. He's going to give us understanding. If we just walk with him, we'll get this thing right. We want everybody else to have something that we've not been partaker of. But I'm especially talking to people who just your children are little. Be staying in the Holy Ghost day in, day out. Let them see you float. You watch me coming in this meeting. You're not going to see me coming in all dry mouth. I got rivers flowing out. Amen. You know what I'm saying? I'm coming in. I'm going to go out. I enter his courts with praise. I enter into his gates with thanksgiving. He that prays in the Holy Ghost offers thanks most excellently. It's true. I'm a Holy Ghost preacher like Jesus. I'm a Holy Ghost preacher just like Paul. Not really sorry, but I'm just saying that.
Hallelujah.
Because he's the dividing line. He comes to reveal Simon the sorcerers and all the rest. Philip went down to preach. They received Jesus and they were baptized in water, but none of the Holy Ghost, the gift of the Holy Ghost was not poured out upon them. Peter and John came down. And when they laid hands on them, they prayed for them, they received the gift of the Holy Ghost. And we know what happened when they prayed for them, they received the gift of the Holy Ghost. Same thing happened to everyone else who was prayed for and received the gift of the Holy Ghost. They all spake with other tongues. Huh? You can't tell me that you jumped in the water when you dry. Hallelujah. You in the water, you wet just like I am. Try to tell me you're standing, you're in the water. You're not in the water, you're dry. You're baptized, now your hair's dry. You ain't baptized in nothing. You're baptized in you, you're baptized in your circumstances, you're baptized in your will, you're baptized immersed in what your desires of your own, heart are. I'm talking about you getting baptized in Father's will, Father's desires, Father's glory. Where it takes over your ability to speak. Would you like to see an entryway in? Many times I would like to stop at this point and just become completely given over to that realm of glory where we are beside ourselves, as Paul said. But I just keep preaching because I already know how to walk in this place, yield myself over to this realm. I'm preaching to you too. Now, I know that if I give myself over to that realm right now of divine glory and begin to let the Holy Ghost speak in that language that only Father can understand, unless you are functioning in a tongue that needs to be interpreted, some of you will be caught up in it. Others of you are just going to sit there and go. And so I'm going to preach and minister to those who would just sit there and look like that. Tell you, go quite away. I'm interested in you. And really, that's really what Paul was saying when he was talking about, wait a minute, guys, when he was saying, hold up a second now. We got people coming in here. They don't even know who Jesus is yet. You listen, you're offering praise most excellently, but they're without understanding. They don't know what's going on. Let's go ahead and minister to them till they caught away too. We want every one of you to be caught away in the realms of God's anointing, the word that you baptize in the Holy Ghost right now, to be able to yield to him right now, so that you're baptized in the Holy Ghost tomorrow, able to yield to him tomorrow, in such a way that all the things that Father said, he's freely supplying, freely giving, the results that he's made available to us, the authority over all the works of darkness and over all the elements of this world would be ours to have, realized. They would occupy us. They would be seen visible in our lives. He says the carnal mind, or that which is earthly. Think about the earthly interests. I want you to hear this, because this is what God the Holy Ghost is saying to you tonight. Many of you don't really understand the manifest presence of the Lord. The impacts, the force of God's glory has never impacted you like the force of earthly issues, finances, physical needs for food, for drink, for clothes, the issues of security, your concerns, your fears, all the things that would try from an earthly dimension, which you continually dealing with, and some of you more than others on a daily basis. It constantly has your emotions on a roller coaster, and more on a coaster than a roller. I mean, you know what I'm saying? I would like some more high points, as it were, in the spirit, because it looks a little bit more like coasting to me. Staying in the same kind of spiritual dimension and spiritual state. Father has a force of heaven that is greater than any force known to you in an earthly realm, greater than any force of earthly hunger, any greater force than earthly thirst, greater force than earthly need or concern. It's time you understand how to live in the heavenly. It's time that you quit being earthly minded, because the Lord says to this, look what he says. He says, because those that are earthly minded are carnally minded. Because it's just the carnal things, the natural earthly things. I think sometimes the unredeemed understand some of the definitions of these words better than the saints. Huh? From which carnival is derived. Carnal thinking, carnal living. That which is carnal, and how it's applied in modern terminology with respect to lasciviousness. He says the carnal mind is death, but the mind of the Holy Ghost. I know many of your Bibles may say spiritually minded, but it's the same spirit and the same word that is used everywhere else in these verses of Scripture, Romans chapter 8, up to this point. So why translate it differently? It's the mind of the Spirit. You're either going to be a meathead, as one person said, because you can't actually translate carnal as meat. Okay, you could. That's not what it's saying. You can either be a meathead, hallelujah, which is another way of saying small-minded. You can either be caught up in your earthly concerns and earthly interests, and all you're going to do is minister yourself doubt, fear, unbelief. All you're going to have is a manifestation of human fruits, which are mostly going to be dissension, questions, concerns, debates, strife, envy, what about me's. Everything that the Lord says is the work of the
flesh,
the unredeemed man. See, Paul said in Ephesians chapter 2, we all had our conversations in past times when we were alienated by wicked works in our minds. Hey? Yep. Ephesians chapter 2. And I'll tell you right now, it's all I can do not to be translated right now. I'm really holding back. I tell you, I just about to go into Holy Ghost joy unspeakable here. There's a couple times I just about started running, because I mean, you know, I tell you, it's pretty energetic right now. It's pretty energizing. The presence of the Lord, this wonderful, I pray that you, every one of you, begin to receive of the atmosphere which is present. I pray that every one of you begin to receive the supply of heaven that is freely being given. It's up to you. Father, begin to create within your life such praise, such rejoicing, such joy. He began to cause songs to erupt from you. Be filled with the Spirit. Begin to speak to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. See, the Lord said church isn't about singing and preaching. It's about flowing in the Holy Ghost that produces singing and preaching. Somebody said, I'm all disoriented. I thought we were supposed to sing first. We didn't even sing. Because reality of it is, when I'm at home, I got to put on the CD, I got to light the candles and put on the incense. you got yourself some other thing going on, man. You got something going on that has nothing to do with what Christ Jesus has supplied. You're creating your own atmosphere. God, the Holy Ghost, has come to produce an atmosphere, divine presence, a glory of manifest presence. Hallelujah. So, he says the carnal mind is the enemy of God. It's at enmity. It is at strife. It is in a tension of opposing that which God would do. Well, could that potentially be some people's problems? You hear me now. Could that potentially be somebody's problem? Somebody said, I don't know what's wrong with me. You know, you say God is freely given and all that we have to do is receive, but I'm all frustrated. I'm not receiving anything. Well, could it be that you're walking in such earthly interest that your thinking and the way that you're processing what God is saying, what His purpose for your life, has actually resulted in a place where you're opposing God through your thinking, through your thoughts, through what you believe? Can you hear me? There's a cure. You ready? There's a cure. It's not subject to the law of God, the spiritual laws of life. We're not talking about the law of Moses. Are you with me? Mm-hmm. The laws of life. Spiritual laws of life are the laws of the life of the Spirit that is in Christ Jesus. It's not subject to the ways or the laws or the things that God has ordained. Neither indeed can be. It's not possible. Can you hear me? Yeah. As long as you're wrapped up in the fear, as long as you're wrapped up in all the concern, as long as your interest and your direction is all about how your bills are going to get paid. You know, people decide how they're going to give to God based upon if they're taken care of first. Did you know that? It's true. That's just the outward manifestation of a long list of results for the same kind of thinking. When you begin to trust God with everything, He becomes everything. When you begin to allow God's word to work on the inside of you to produce a confidence that you're going to have that which Father has declared, the results will be yours. That which He's promised will be experienced by you. He says this. He says, so then, they that are in the flesh cannot please God. So he actually equates that then really on the same level of what he said in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6, said, without faith, it's impossible to please God. So you're really not even in the faith. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
The foundation of faith is trust. All Paul's defense of faith was based upon Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4, that the righteous shall live by trusting God. He took that, a Hebrew word, emit, and he now took it over into a New Testament, New Covenant setting, and now begin to declare it in the context of faith, which is a whole nother level of trusting God, as it were. It's a whole nother dimension of trusting God. Abraham trusted God on the plane of that which he had as a man the ability to trust with, and that which Father also supplied to him because he was willing to receive, he was willing to obey God. Surely there was a supernatural divine provision given to him. But now it's all together on a whole nother level because the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ has resulted in a new creation, a new creature, that which is now joined unto the Holy Ghost, one with the Holy Ghost, to now freely receive everything that Father is giving. However, if you're going to walk after earthly interests, it's going to shut you down. And Jesus ministered the same in Matthew chapter 6. He says all these things. He says, take no thought. Take no thought for what you should wear. Take no thought for what you should eat. Listen, he said, all these things the nations are seeking after. And he fundamentally is saying it's going to shut down faith in your life. He said, but rather seek first the kingdom of God. Make the kingdom of God and His righteousness everything that you need and everything that you desire and all that the provision that Father has planned for your life to be given to you through. and all these things will be added to you. Put me first. Let me be your provider. Let me be your shield and your exceeding great reward. Let me walk it out. Let me walk out a relationship with you, and let me establish within you that which is much more precious than anything else, including gold or riches. The trying of your faith. Let me bring forth within you faith that's tried, proven, established. Well, how are you going to do that? You're going to have to walk in the Holy Ghost. Because he says here, he says, they that are in the flesh cannot please God. But look at this verse. But you are not in the flesh. I'm not in an unredeemed state. Hello, I'm not in an unredeemed state. I'm not in an I am in a state where human ability could still function, where self could still function. Are you listening to me? Yeah. What am I supposed to do with that? I'm supposed to deny it. I'm not supposed to go live my own life. I'm telling you right now, I love being in the mountains, running cows around, being on horseback, taking care of streams, doing water, chopping trees, doing all that stuff. I love it. That's my element. I could, if I didn't say no, that's not what my life is about. I'm following the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what I would be doing. I love it. I'm going to fundamentally deny myself. It's not about my plans, my purpose. It's not about whether or not I have the stuff that I think that I need. Who wants security in this life alone? I don't want security in this life. Because if I have security in this life, I don't have security in that life. I'm going to have all my security in Him. Therefore, I don't need security in this life. I got security in Him. That's security enough. Amen. I don't need anything. I got Him. The Lord is my shepherd. I don't have any needs. The only needs I have is divine needs, heavenly needs. I'm thirsty for more of Him. I'm hungry for Him. I'm not thirsty for the things of this earth. I'm not hungry. My desires, my affections are not divided. That's why I have a perfect heart. Because my affections and my desires aren't divided. I'm not saying I need this amount of money to retire. I heard a commercial that if you don't have $1 million, you can't retire properly. I'm like, most people are not going to retire properly. And now everybody's up in arms. Oh, man, I can have $1 million. All I got to do is go do what this guy says to do. And then now they put their whole trust in some guy who says, you know, I'm going to show you how to spend your money and invest your money, and it's all going to work out. And then he tells you the same kind of spiel when he's sorry that it didn't work out because the economy collapsed. It was something that happened, you know, we didn't foresee. Oh, no joke. You and I are supposed to be able to see clearly. I really like the idea of that one prophetic conference that was canceled because of unforeseen circumstances. It's about time that you and I step into a realm of the things of the Spirit, that we understand what's coming down the road. He allows us to see out into the future. I'm out driving on the mountains. I do it a lot. I could see 100 miles in the distance. There's one place I go around to Bend on 395. I can see Shasta, and it's over 100 miles away, Mount Shasta. I like looking out into the future. It's going to take me an hour to get there. No, I'll take a look.
Hallelujah.
And I can drive 100 miles an hour, but you know, inside joke, but okay. I do drive a little fast. I can see out into the future. Sometimes I can look out there and I can say, oh, it's raining out there. Because I'm at a vantage point where I can see way out. I can predict what's about to come from that place, just in the natural seeing. It's wonderful to be there in a vantage point in God. Now walk upon our high places. The highest place of all has been made available to us. Habakkuk said, I will go up upon my high places. He understood. He received an anointing to understand how to enter in to that realm by the Holy Ghost, by the Spirit that was given to him. You and I have access to the Father. We have access by the Holy Ghost. You realize you have access. You have an entrance made available to you. God will come to you and he will minister to you. He will cause you to understand and see and know the way to enter into a realm. He will minister to you an entrance into this realm of the kingdom. You got to give yourself to these things. You can't constantly give yourself to earthly things and say you're being strengthened to, and matured in the realms of the things of the Spirit to be caught away in the glory, to know and understand how to access these realms, move and function and flow in these various different dimensions of the Spirit. God will show you. You'll be able to see when somebody's about ready to move in miracles. You'll be able to see the miracle activated. You'll be able to see and understand and be discerning to the gift of faith. I know when the gift of faith is here. I can sense it. I can understand. I can see it. I recognize it. It's something that goes beyond the sight of men. Somebody said, what you see, I can't explain it because it's nothing that you could describe in the physical. It's another sense realm. I tell you right now, the sight realm, the five senses are overrated senses. There are spiritual senses that are far more important to us. That's why Father has purposed to leave himself and conceal himself in an unseen realm that he might develop these senses in our life. But if we're not going to participate with the Holy Ghost, these senses are never going to be developed. We just rather walking after the natural five senses. And all we do is confine to that which those five senses dictate to us and describe and declare. Well, the doctor said. Well, the lawyer said. Well, the expert said. Who cares? What did God say? God said and it was so. The doctor's wrong time and time again. The lawyer's wrong time and time again. The expert's wrong time and time again. God's never wrong. Why is it that people want to go ahead and believe people who are constantly proven wrong over and again? Instead of believing God who's right every time. I don't get it. It's not even logical. It's carnal thinking. Earthly thinking. You have developed your five senses to the point that you really have a lot of confidence in your perception, in your skill set. I have a vote of no confidence for me. I have no confidence in the flesh, my own human ability. I have no confidence in my own perceptions. Vote of no confidence. So much so that I deny it, I shut it down. Father, I want what you have for me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm going to live it. I tell you right now, I don't want to live any other way. You don't want to live any other way either. You just get over here into this realm, get these things activated in your spirit. You want more. But you're not in the flesh, but you in the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Hallelujah. If the Holy Ghost is in you. He says, but you in the Holy Ghost, if the Holy Ghost or the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now, if any man doesn't have the Spirit of God, the Spirit of Christ, he don't belong to God. How did the mighty men of the earth recognize, or what did they say about the servants of the Lord like Daniel? They said the Spirit of God is in him. The Spirit of God is in him. How? They saw a display of the power of God in his life. Why? Because he gave himself to allowing God to be the one who spoke through him and acted through him rather than it being spending his opinion. People spend their opinion over and over and over again to where that they've now fortified in their opinion and God can't get a word in edgewise. They have so developed strength and confidence in their own insights and their own judgments, they can't walk after the mind of the Spirit. So there is no display of God. Even though they've been born of the Spirit, they've remained infants. They've remained babies. They haven't really even begun to walk yet. It just dawdle them, pamper them, burp them, powder, you know, baby powder their pew. So it's a little more comfortable. That's really the state of things. But it's time to get activated. It's time to start moving in these things. It's time to say, you know what, I'm not talking my own opinion anymore. I'm not going to sit around and talk about sports and the weather and all this other nonsense. I'm getting my tongue over to some holy stuff. Yeah. I'm not talking run down people and talk about this thing and that thing and what I think about how this person did this and that person did that. Quiet. Quiet. Shh. Or maybe get real harsh and just say, shut up. Somebody said, I don't like shut up. That means shut down. That, well, good. Shut down. Because that ain't going to get you anywhere. You're just going to have to shut it down. Some place you're going to have to understand that God's power has been given to you to bring every thought into captivity. That those thoughts that are going on in your life, that are being imposed upon you by the five sense realm, by the carnal thinking, by the earthly interests, are not of God.
and they're going to keep you from growing and maturing in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. And you're not going to get anywhere. And so all we're going to do is come and pretend and practice the word of knowledge and really not have much of a word of knowledge at all, and it quickly turn into some familiar spirit. I'm telling you, I am laboring. I am interested in seeing the glory and the majesty that Father placed in this church by the Holy Ghost once again being evident within our midst. I'm ready now to see the dead raised to life again. I'm ready. I'm interested in seeing the exploits of God's understanding and knowledge impacting the nations and cause the rulers and the leaders to tremble. Come on. That's what happens when the Spirit of the Lord, the Holy Ghost, is allowed control over His house. But if we don't give Him control over our lives individually, it's very difficult for Him to have the control over His house when we come collectively. Because everybody's already separated and divided by individual opinions and interests. Reality of it is you and I are supposed to, when we come into the meeting, we're supposed to so yield ourselves to the Lord that we all baptized by the Holy Ghost down into the person of Jesus Christ, one body. Yeah, that's the yielding to the Holy Ghost. Somebody said, oh, we are baptized by one Spirit into one body, as though it was one event. No, it is a continual ongoing relationship, people. It's not an event. It's not an event only. People want to live events. It's a relationship. It's an ongoing walking it out with God and continually submitted to that which He's purposed, and that is that you and I, all of us, are collectively, individually, and collectively by the Holy Ghost immersed down into the body of Christ, the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, and out of that we begin to move and function as one man. Then the church is seen. You yield your members to anything else that's going to come out to you. It's going to come out to your life in every dimension of your life. The Lord doesn't need you to be perfect and fully mature to use you. You understand me? But you cannot hang on to wrong things and think that God is going to be able to do through your life what He's purposed to do. You're just going to have to sit down and just stay right there until you decide, I'm not going to live my life like this no more. I'm changing. I'm going to touch heaven. I'm quit justifying myself and talking about how this thing and that thing. You know what? In the surfing community, if you talk about what happened 2 days ago, you're just basically a loser. Who wants to hear what happened 2 days ago? In most other communities, I talk about what you did 5 years ago. Who cares what you did? What did you do today? What's going on right now? But yet, we want to talk about what happened 2,000 years ago, and then Pharaoh figured that we're all good. No, it's the living presence of Jesus right now. What's going on right now? Not what happened last year. Huh? It's what God wants. It's not about you and I having some kind of self-promotion through our declaration of what God did through our life. It's about rather wanting all that Father has purposed to do through our life to be fully revealed and manifest. All that event did was make me more hungry. All those things that happened then just made me more passionate about laying hold on God and Father, use me. I'm telling you right now, if you have not looked around, Father's in need of some people who fully surrender to Him so the life of Jesus may be made manifest through them. Huh? I mean, just look around. Any volunteers? It's going to cost you everything. It's going to cost you everything. Everything that's dear to you and everything that's important to you. And I'm going to put it in a category of self. Because I'm going to tell you right now, people live more out of the realms of self than they do out of the realms of the Holy Ghost. And that's what prevents you. That's what prevents you from receiving. You don't know. I know you don't know because you've not been willing to understand. Because God has given freely this revelation. He's freely given this insight. The Spirit of wisdom revelation is here. You decide that you're not going to be hard-headed and hard-hearted anymore. So you're going to take hold of the living God and have what He described in His Word and not come up without it. Men of the generations, they saw God. They went after God. I mean, some of the great leaders, I mean, it's pretty radical when you crawl into you have no other place to go to get away, so you crawl into a hollow log and you lay there till heaven comes. Huh? You just want to get shut in with God. And then heaven really came because God used you to touch the whole generation. It's just, how needy are you for the reality of heaven? And I'm going to say this over and again because it's so important. These things are given to us. They're freely given to us. All we have to do is agree with them. The issue is, though, we've allowed things to be fortified in our life that shut down the flow of that which Father has freely given. And it's just time we just say, no more. I'm no longer living after self-interest. I'm going to start with my mouth. I told people a long time ago, some of you heard it a long time ago, go buy yourself some duct tape. And very few people went and bought the duct tape. I didn't see any duct tape going around. Because some people's issue is just that their mouth is constantly speaking things out of carnal interest, out of a purely human realm, human thinking, doubt, unbelief. It's not according to God's word. It's not the description of that which the Holy Ghost is saying. Now what you're doing is you're fortifying, building yourself up, maturing and establishing yourself in just the opposite of what God the Holy Ghost has purposed to do through your life. You need to switch the thing off. You learn to talk to God. I can tell you right now, I can pass this microphone around and I can tell you just how much you talk to God by the way that you start speaking through the microphone. And it has nothing to do with the loudness of your voice, the tone of your voice. It has to do with the way you talk to Him. It has to do with the way the Holy Spirit, in other words, is able to communicate through you to speak to the Father, the way that the Spirit of the Son has been yielded to in your life. That has a manifestation of the way you begin to talk to the Father. I'm just telling you, dear people, I'm not going to do that to you, but you can do your own. You can get yourself a recorder, and you can just start talking to the Father, and then you can listen to that and go, wow, does that sound meat-headed? Or does that sound like the prayer of the Spirit? Does that sound just like me talking, someone coming up with some ideas? Or does that sound like the utterance of the Spirit of the Son? I mean, I believe Father honors it when we get that real with Him. Romans chapter 8 is telling us how to walk in the fullness of the maturity of the Son. Paul's going to bring this all to a conclusion about being conformed to the image of the Son in everything. And by the time we get to verse 29, he's going to tell us by the time we get to verse 32 that everything that Father has, He's freely given to us. If He spared not His own Son, He's so desperate for relationship with us that He spared not His own Son but offered Him up for the sins of us all, how shall He not also by Him freely give us all things? It's freely He's given us all things. But Paul's telling us right here the things that hinders. He's telling us the things that would stand and block our entrance and block the supply and the flow of divine grace into our lives. Well, will we hear it? Is it going to be a battle? Yeah, it's going to be a battle. It's going to be a battle of your thoughts. It's going to be a battle of your will. It's going to even, to some degrees, especially for those of you who are not married, it's going to be a battle, even physical battle. I'm going to tell you right now, there is no sin or temptation that will come against you except for that which is common unto man. And God's made a way of escape so that you may be able to bear it. God has purposed that you put to death anything that you don't allow it to exist. In other words, anything that is opposed to the ways and the movings of God in your body, in your mind, in your thinking, in your behavior. You know, most people ruin everything by what comes out of your mouth. Did you know that? Did you know that your mouth, your words have more impact on you than anything else according to the Scripture? By even the confession of your mouth, it is made into salvation. Huh? You know, you can actually curse yourself and you can bless yourself. You can curse men and you can bless them. However, sweet and bitter water is not supposed to come out of the same fountain. How can you bless God and curse men? And people cursing all the time. Even doing things like, I don't believe they're right with God. I don't believe that person's right with God. Instead of getting down on your face saying, oh God, establish so and so in the faith. I can't imagine a worse curse than that, can you? I don't believe they're right with God. Because basically what you're saying is, they're not right with God. My position and my testimony is they're not right with God. That wouldn't be the intercession I would want somebody to give to me or for me. Neither would you want anyone to give that for you. If Christ be in you, the body is dead. because of sin. See, now the thing about it is this. You have to understand this. What's being said. Because the body, and Paul's going to go into this more, the body was subject to death and corruption because of sin, because of Adam's transgression. So our body is still dead in the sense that it's under a death sentence, if you would. Although it's God's divine purchased possession, temple of the Holy Ghost, it's still under a death sentence. We're going to the grave. We're going to grow old. We're going to die. It's the point that a man wants to die. And now you can even take it to another layer and say the actions of the body in which things that the body would do, and we're talking about every part of your body, especially your mouth. Some people think about the lower part of their anatomy. I'm talking about the top part. Are you listening to me? I'm just trying to help you understand things, okay? And so I see this guy, he just like tells him, you know, kind of crudely sometimes. But bottom line of it is that your body, the things that your body would demand or try to have function in it, because that's really how the whole display of your life is lived out through the actions of your body. Your body is dead because of sin. And you have to understand that in light of that you reckon yourself to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God. You reckon yourself that God bore in his Christ Jesus, God, Christ Jesus, bore in his own body our sins on the tree, that we now being dead to sin might live unto God by whose wound we were healed. So here we are, we're in Christ Jesus. The body is dead to sin, or rather, forgive me, dead because of sin, but the spirit is life because of righteousness. So here we have, and Paul's going to bring it to this point. He's going to say that if that same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwells in your mortal body, if the same Holy Ghost that raised Jesus up from the dead dwells in your mortal body, dwells in you, he shall also make alive your mortal body. He's talking about the sickness, he's talking about the disease, and he's talking about the corruption. He's going to make that very pointed. Though the body may be dead because of sin, though the body may be corruptible because of sin, that because of the Holy Ghost, we're living out a life of righteousness. Now listen to this. But if the spirit of him that raised, this is the next verse of scripture. But so the body's dead because of sin. Got that? But if the Holy Ghost, and I want to say this once again, but the Holy Ghost or the Spirit of Christ, forgive me, but the Spirit of life, but the Holy Ghost is life, life-giving force, the life-giving power, receive the life of Christ, the abundant life. Are you with me? The life that's coming out of you like rivers, inexhaustible, unlimited expressions of God's life, the life of God, the life of the Spirit, the life of the Father, eternal life, all synonyms. Don't forget all the rest of the scripture and doctrines of God that you already know when you're listening to this. Are you with me? But the Holy Ghost has brought life. What kind of life? He that hath the Son hath life. Born again life, new creation life, new nature life. Are you with me? Okay. Born of the Spirit life. But the Spirit is life because of righteousness. And he says, but if the Holy Ghost or the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also make alive your mortal bodies by the Holy Ghost that dwells in you. And so somebody said, well, he's talking about the resurrection of the dead. No, he's talking about your immortal bodies, not your immortal bodies. He said, I'll make alive your mortal body. I will quicken your mortal body. I will give you the ability to live in divine health. I'll give you the ability and the strength to not have to sleep so much. I'll give you the ability, and it goes on. I'll quicken your mortal body. I'll do something for you better than carrot juice could ever do. Or whole wheat bread or whatever else it is you putting your trust in. Beets and spinach. I'll bring health to your body. I'll bring life to your body. Holy Ghost life to your body. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Long life. See, Abraham, God called, Abraham said, Abraham lived to a good old age. Well, how does God define a good old age? Huh? Anybody in here know how God defines a good old age? How old did Abraham live to be? Huh?
175.
Yeah, 175. That'd be a sign and a wonder. You're going to have yourself some quickening. God quickened his body so that he considered not his own body being dead. Huh? No longer able to have the vitality of those functions of life that was there when he was young. And that's really the same application here. To make alive your mortal body. To quicken it. To give it the vitality and the vigor of every organ and every part functioning to its optimal ability. This is better for you than a facelift. Yes. He'd be the lifter of your head. Yes, his glory would be the lifter of your head. Amen. I'm praying over these wrinkles right now. Somebody said that they had something to take all the wrinkles off, and I said, I need about a 5-gallon bucket of that stuff. But I'm kind of happy about mine. Mine makes a cross. When I was young, I told the Lord I was going to tattoo a cross on my forehead. And the Lord told me not to do it because I'd alienate myself from people. So he went ahead and gave me one. So I'm like that one. I'll leave that one. Sometimes when I get real tired, I have the full crucifixion scene. I have a cross here. I'm not kidding you. I have a cross here. I have a cross here. I have the whole Golgotha scene, Mount Calvary, right here on the forehead. I'm happy with that. I'm happy with that. Hallelujah. Therefore, we have no debt to the flesh. But no obligations to the flesh. To live after the flesh. Because the Spirit of Christ is in us. And the Spirit of the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of life, is at work because of righteousness. Because the same Holy Ghost that raised Jesus from the dead is living on the side of me and quickening my mortal body. I have no obligation. Because of all these things that we say about what the Holy Ghost is doing and supplying, rather than having an earthly existence, we've got a heavenly one. Rather than living after human interests, we're living after the will of God. Let's show you two verses of Scripture real quickly. I was quickened by it this morning. I've just been quickened by it again. Look here in 1 Peter chapter 4 with me real quickly. I'm going to blow your mind. I'm going to blow your natural mind so you'll have a heavenly one. In 1 Peter chapter 4, for as much then as Christ has suffered in the flesh, did Christ Jesus suffer in the sin nature? No. In the human existence. For as much as Christ has suffered in the flesh, arm yourself likewise with the same mind, for he that has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin. That he should no longer live the rest of his time in the flesh to the lust of men, but rather he no longer lives himself, no longer lives his life after the desires of the human dictate, after those who are born after the flesh, the natural existence, the natural human interest, huh? But to the will of God. You with me? You with me? Now turn to 1 John. Turn back, forgive me. Turn to John. Turn to John chapter 1. Gospel of John chapter 1. Turn to Gospel of John chapter 1. I know I'm not telling you about the mark of the beast tonight and captivating all of your interest and whatnot. About the coming Antichrist and how he could be ISIS and making you all feel right, you know, whatever. But I am telling you that which is most needful for you and which is most applicable to you. Hallelujah. Amen. John chapter 1. It's amazing. I listen to all these different preachers on today. I'm just searching to hear the voice of the Lord on Christian television. I gave up and went to bed. I'm like, Lord, do you have any servants speaking your word? Here we go. Listen to this. Listen to this. Listen to this. What on earth are you talking about, guys? Why are you, what are you saying? What is coming out of your mouth? What Bible are you reading? by what spirit you speak of. Just amazing.
God help us. Good thing he is.
Verse 13. In the view of being made the sons of God, which were not born of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of men, but of God. When we all of a sudden we begin to understand we're born of God, we don't live after our own will and after our own interest anymore, but we live under a divine mandate for a divine purpose. And now we're going to give ourselves over. We're going to consecrate ourselves to saying, okay, forget about all of my earthly interests, all my earthly visions, all my earthly plans. And some people, you know, the older you get, maybe you're 50 years old, you come into the kingdom of God, you've built your whole life on your own earthly existence. That is a pretty radical transition now. Then now all your interests are going to be heavenly. And then how about people that have made agreements with hell and made compromises and now with earthly interest and now have validated themselves as being as much in the Holy Ghost as anybody else, and they're not living after the Holy Ghost. That's an extreme deception, because if the light is in you, be darkness. How great is that darkness? Had to think about it, dear people. Had to think, consider these things. For if we live after the flesh, you will die. But if you through the Holy Ghost do not allow to exist or be dead, because this is the same word that is used in Romans chapter 4, where Abraham said, consider not his own body now being dead. Okay? He didn't use the word mortify and all these other different theological explanations that people derive from this one verse of scripture. You just simply understand it like this. You, by the Holy Ghost, do not allow anything to exist in your body that is not that which is in complete obedience to the living God, to the will of God, to the ways of God. We, by the Holy Ghost, not after human ability, not after discipline, not after some other, you know, form of godliness, but not having the power, but after the Holy Ghost, you do not allow to exist in your body anything that is not of God. You call, as it were, everything that would function in your life or try to manifest or exist in your life from an earthly context, from a fleshly context, from an unredeemed context, you don't allow it to exist. Then Scripture says you shall live. For as many as are, here we go, led, guided, taught by the Holy Ghost. What does it say right there? You're the sons of God. So by the Holy Ghost, you're simply saying, I'm not going to allow to exist in my body, because everything about our life, good or bad, is going to be manifested through our body. There are doctors that have totally distracted people and said, oh, you know, your body's your whole problem, you know. No, my goodness gracious, everything... The body without the spirit is dead. I mean, come on. The body only expresses that which the spirit, as it were, dictates. And so here, we're now living under the power of the Holy Ghost. And by the Holy Ghost, the only manifestations that's going to go on in our body are those things which the Holy Ghost produce. Did you know that your body really can manifest a great contrast of either being sad, depressed, or being happy and glad? That's a function of your body. There's more going on in the function of your face and what's coming out of your mouth. Are you with me? Yeah. The disposition of your life than all the other interests put together. So the Lord says, as many of you as are led by the Spirit of God, you are the sons of God. They're the sons of God. As many as to, by the Holy Ghost, don't allow anything to exist in their body except for that which the Holy Spirit is doing and supplying. You're the ones that are living. Because the wages of sin is death. Paul's already discussed that. He told us that we're supposed to have the evidence or the fruits of our life under are supposed to be righteousness, and that would produce what? Holiness. Huh? Yeah. Hello? Yeah. What are we talking about here? What are we talking about? How you put your hair in a bun? Whether or not you wear jewelry or not? Somebody said, men, you're really your holiness, aren't you? You don't wear jewelry. Well, I just, you know what? I lost my ring. I have a beautiful diamond ring. And I haven't found one like it, so I don't wear a ring. And I had a great watch. I mean, it was gold watch with many, many diamonds in it. And somebody, I don't know what happened to that. And I haven't found one to replace it. And so, I mean, you know, it just, you buy a Rolex, I'll put it on. And no problem. But give me the $30,000 one. Don't give me the $3,000 one.
Hallelujah.
I just said that for the pious. With emphasis on the pie. Okay. There's nothing to do with whether you wear your hair in a bun or whether you don't wear jewelry. I guarantee you, I don't want to see the crack on women's chest nor on men's backside. People need to dress properly. Okay? Are you listening to me? You need to put clothes on. That's why I try to wear a handkerchief with me. That way some women don't know how to dress. I just go ahead and dress them. Come up for me to pray for them. And put additional clothes on. Because I'm not interested in looking at your boobs. It's wrong. It's unholy. It's the fruit of unrighteousness. Women become addicted at being stared at. Become addicted to attention. That's why they do it. Dress unholy, not modestly. So I do talk about those kinds of things. It has nothing to do with buns or jewelry. Or whether or not you little wear your little thing on your head. It has to do with the activity of the Holy Ghost in our life. Paul's already laid this foundation. He labored to lay this foundation in Romans chapter 6. To have the fruits of righteousness unto holiness, and the end thereof being what? Life. Everlasting. You're going to have to learn how to dress. I tell you right now, if I came out upon you on the beach somewhere and you had some kind of uniform on, it was less than what you wear under your normal clothes, I'd go grab a blanket and throw it on you and talk to you a little while. I believe in covering people up, helping them, poor things. It's so foolish they don't know how to dress themselves. People are so foolish they don't even know how to speak properly. Speak all kinds of evil and strife and division and doubt and unbelief instead of speaking faith. Sad. And I'm, you know what? You know what impacts me the most? Not what individuals really are doing, but the impact it has on the glory and the honor and the majesty that belongs to His name. That has a direct result to the way we live in and acting. And I'm not going to be tolerating it. Amen. I'm not going to be tolerating. Are you listening to me? I'm not going to be tolerating misbehavior. Amen. Every time my parents spanked me, it was all about me understanding that there is a consequence to wrongdoing. I'm going to spank you. By the help and the grace of God, I'm going to do a better and more effective job of it. Amen.
Amen.
Somebody said, you can't do that. Well, let's just see. Let's just see what God would do when He begins to declare His judgments in His mercy. To say, you can't live that way no more. You can't act that way no more. You can't behave that way anymore. And it should be a strength in you. So let the righteous smite me. In other words, let the righteous spank me. What will it be to you?
Help.
Will it be a blessing? Will it be a help? Well, listen, if you deserve spanking, take it. Yep. Like, take it properly. People are amazed. The Lord says every son that he received, he chastens. And people say, well, I'm being chastened. What's happening now? This doesn't seem just or right. No. It's just evidence that you're being corrected by the Lord. Hallelujah. You can't live. You can't continue to allow things that are wrong to go on in your life. And if you can't see it, that's why God's given watchmen. Say, look, you stop doing that right now. Don't do that anymore. You're wrong. Well, I'm an adult. You can't talk to me like that. No, you don't look like an adult to me. Because you're looking at your outward form, your body uniform. I'm looking at your spirit. I'm looking at that which lasts forever. I'm not looking at your outward form. I'm an adult. How old are you? I'm 72. That's baby compared to eternal life. What do you mean you're an adult? What does that mean I'm an adult? That means now I'm above reproof. I'm above being directed, instructed, corrected. Well, you don't mean that, do you? Why don't you be converted, become like a little child, and lose all that burden that comes along with being such an adult? Amen. Listen to this. Because it's an evidence when you walk in the Holy Ghost. He says to us, you've not received the spirit of bondage again to fear. Once again, he's right back into those earthly concerns. He's right back into the realms of carnal thinking, which produces what? Death. He's dealing with the contrast between flowing in the Holy Ghost, which is life and peace. He's saying, you know, look, don't allow fear. It's really another way of saying it. You've been delivered from this. Don't allow it. It's not allowed to exist in your life. I'm telling you, anybody that's around me, I'll look at them. If I detect any fear, I come down on pretty heavy. If I detect doubt and unbelief, I'm coming down on heavy. If I detect any demon activity, I'll start screaming and hollering. I just don't allow it. And then I get into churches and I see demon activity happening all over the place. And when I first began the ministry, I didn't even know how to handle it. It's like, cast the devil out of everybody. To say, what on earth are you guys doing? Who are you? What spirit of you are you of? You have not the spirit of God. The Holy Ghost isn't there. I was dealing with, there's a thing that happens to me when I'm really dealing, especially in the context of churches, and it's only happening in the context of churches, and I'm dealing with strongholds of spiritual darkness, my mouth goes completely and totally dry. It's the greatest, craziest physiological stress. Completely and totally dry. And I'm like, Lord, how is it that these strongholds have been allowed to be erected within the context of your churches to this degree? I don't know, but he sent me to set them free. Amen. He sent you to set them free. You think that we would be devoted and dedicated to being those who function and move in the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ? Are we going to be just kind of, you know, slap happy normal about something that's completely demonic or out of order or not according to the things in the order of the Holy Ghost around here? No, sir. I'm just let you know you're in the wrong place. You don't fit in. Walking out of the realms of the demonic realm, I speak in strife and division. You don't fit in, man. You belong outside. And then you need to labor to enter into the straight gate. Amen.
Amen.
You don't want to be told that. I can't believe you told me that. Well, come here, I'll tell it to you again. Hallelujah. So that you can make sure that I sent the right message so that you would do what? Repent. Change. You need to be transfigured by thinking different. Who received the spirit of sonship? Somebody said, I've been adopted. I wasn't adopted. I was born into this. I don't believe the huiathesis should have ever been translated to adoption. It doesn't even belong. It doesn't even make sense. It's out of context both here and also in Galatians chapter 4, where it's also used in verse 6. It's out of context. Huiathesis means sonship. Huia, son, theesis, is a word for a derivative of thea, God. Can it potentially have as one of its meanings adoption? Yeah, but it also has a meaning as a son of God or sonship. So why don't we just go with that? I don't understand, but nonetheless, I don't know, there's lots of things I don't understand. It's sonship, where we receive the spirit of sonship, whereby we cry, Dad. And then I hear these people go through these long speeches about how, you know, you're a preferred child if you're adopted. You were born into this, man. The Holy Ghost came upon you, and you were born again on a level that Nicodemus said, how can I enter the second time into my mother's womb? He said, you're going to be born of the Spirit. Hallelujah. New creation. Washing in the water of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. Because your identity is so important. What are you speaking out of? Are you speaking out of fear, which is out of the realms of earthly interest, self-preservation, a need of to feel secure because you're so insecure because you're living under the spirit of fear? So many people are so insecure. They're so intimidated. They live under the spirit of fear. Oh, I wanted to move. I felt like God was moving on me to say something, but I just felt intimidated. You're under the spirit of fear. Well, what are you supposed to do? You're supposed to pray in the Holy Ghost. You're supposed to yield yourself to the Holy Ghost to where that you now have the confidence and the authority of a son. That's going to give you a lot of boldness, a lot of certainty. You got to understand here now, God's showing you the things that you're yielding to that are wrong, that are going to keep you from the realms of all that he has given so that you can fully represent him, so your face and your life can shine with the glory of his presence, so that the Spirit of the Lord can produce within you his prophecy, his speaking. You're supposed to live and speak as the oracles of God, those who are constantly declaring that which God himself is speaking. He's using you as a mouthpiece. In other words, an oracle is a radical word to actually use within the context of the sacred, because it was rather more mostly used in the context of the profane when they became possessed by a spirit and began to speak with the mouth of that God, that idol. And the Lord said, we're supposed to be speaking with his mouth. Well, if you're constantly running your mouth, how can you ever speak with God's mouth? So somebody's mouth's going to have to shut down. And I learned this. I heard it in the spirit very early on in life. And I just went. I was reading Ezekiel one day, and the Lord said that his tongue would cleave to the roof of his mouth, and then his word would come upon him, his spirit would come upon him and begin to express his word. Now his tongue would be loosed. I said, oh, Lord, let my tongue also cleave into the roof of my mouth until I speak by your spirit. I'm tired of spitting my opinion. You know what? When I spend it's gotten to the point in my life that I start spitting my own opinion, I feel sick to my stomach. I like that kind of manifestation. I feel like a chill, like a fearful, crazy chill run up and down the back of my neck, as it were. It literally has a physical manifestation because it's that bad. It's like, ooh, you're speaking now. Ooh, creepy. The creepy guy speaking now. Hallelujah. That which is after the natural is ick. I'm so used to that glory of heaven. Ha ropodaya sinomongada. If it alam in the man and mantaya that produces such ecstasy and exhilaration and glory and joy and peace and floods my soul with every good thing talking out of my mouth. And when something else starts coming out, it makes me feel just the opposite. It don't feel good. Putting to death everything that does not supposed to exist in our manifested in our body. See, that which was consecrated to the Lord, no thing other than that which belonged to God was allowed to tread upon its courts or its ground. He said, kill it. Levite, stand here, kill it, thrust it through with the dart if it trespasses. Now you and I, we temple guards. We're not allowing anything to be manifested in our body that is not being produced by the Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah.
Especially right here. That thing right there, kind of, that we keep hidden away because it can be pretty ugly. Could keep it hid away. Nobody likes anybody walking around like this. Just keep it hid away. Huh? Somebody said, your tongue set on fire or hell. Yeah. It's either set on fire or hell or set on fire the Holy Ghost. I'd go with the Holy Ghost if I were you. Tongues of fire. It teaches us how to speak those things of the learned. He teaches us the tongue of the learned, that we may speak the proper kinds of words when it's appropriate in due seasons. God's timings. The Spirit of the Lord should be poured upon all flesh that you and I may prophesy. I'm tired of hearing what men's got to say. I'm tired of hearing what I have to say. I'm tired of hearing, I don't want to hear what you got to say. I'm disinterested. I really liked what, I believe it was Campbell, when Brother Campbell was one of the leading ministers in the Church of England at the time, went and visited with Evan Roberts. It was after the Welsh Revival, I believe it was in the 20s. Welsh Revival took place in 1904, began September 28th, ended right around April. Lasted about 6 months. And Evan Roberts retired to a place of prayer and intercession. And Campbell came in and just wanted to meet with them, you know, just kind of just greeted him and just started talking away and just sitting there just talking away. And Evan Roberts just looked at him, turned away, didn't say nothing, just walked up the stairs and went back to his room. Campbell reports, this is actually his testimony, gives it in a book that's called When Glory Filled the Land. He said, I stood there. First of all, I was thinking, first a minute, a little bit insulted, then I realized, I was talking a bunch of trash. And the man of the Spirit didn't have time to listen to all this nonsense I had coming out of my mouth. And he was filled with Holy Ghost conviction.
Oh boy.
What happens when you become citizens of heaven? And your conversation is in heaven. And all of a sudden, there's a new form of reality. There is a new level of reality. There's a new realm of truth. You're now speaking by the Spirit of the truth. You're not interested in all the fantasies anymore for which most of people's existence is defined by. It's fleeting. It's passing away. None of it's certain. It's constantly evolving, changing, taking on new shapes. It has nothing to do with life. It has nothing to do with eternal life. What happens when you begin speaking after the things of the Spirit? I heard somebody say, oh, you're so spiritually minded, you know earthly good. What? That's actually very good. You should be of no earthly good. Thank you for saying that.
Amen.
I'm so spiritually minded that I'm only of heavenly good.
Amen.
I only have a heavenly value. And then I'll change the earth around me. Hallelujah. Jesus spoke out of heaven. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That God in these last days has spoken by his own Son. Hallelujah. You've borne the image of the earthly. Now it's time to bear the image of the heavenly. You've taken on the identity of Adam's transgression, Adam's disobedience. Now it's time to take on the likeness and the glory of Christ Jesus' obedience and his servitude to the Father and his yieldedness to the Holy Ghost. Because really, I'm talking, man, I want to bring you to a place of being able to understand what John 14:12 means. Jesus said, if you don't believe me, believe me for my work's sake. For it's not me that does the works, but my Father which dwells in me. He testifies of me through these works. That's what he says in verses 10 and 11. Then he says, and these works. And anyone who believes these works that I do in greater works, they shall also do. In other words, he's saying, they will have even this testimony and a greater testimony that Father dwells in them. I want to bring you to that relationship, but first you're going to have to understand how to shut down stuff that is not allowed to be existing in your life. First thing it is, you're going to have to let God, the Holy Ghost, tame your tongue, take control of your tongue. You're speaking. You're thinking. He says then, for the Spirit Himself bears witness, and I know it's in the neuter. And I can understand why it's in the neuter, and you have translated many places itself, because God has so given us the Holy Ghost that sometimes it's almost indistinguishable between His Spirit and our spirit. It's pretty radical. The realms of the Spirit, of living in the realms of the Spirit, of the realms of the spiritual or the realms of the heavenly, because the Holy Ghost brings to us the heavenly. Walking in the Spirit is the same as walking or living in the realms of heaven. And He shows us entrances in, how to function, how to flow in the divine, in the miraculous, in the healings, in the gifts of Spirit, in the wisdom, in the knowledge. He shows us how to function in every dimension of those things which the ministry of Jesus revealed. And all it was living out a life on earth in the realms of heaven. And so living out that life on earth in the realms of heaven shows everything that belongs to death and sin being eradicated and eliminated and no longer having any impact or effect. How about just living a life like that now? I mean, you have to give yourself to this. You're going to have to grow. You're going to have to be strengthened. You're going to have to mature in it by way of participating. It ain't going to happen because you're just sitting around hoping for one day. You stand up and do it. Hallelujah. You start saying, it's mine. You start giving yourself to that, which it all begins at Pentecost. It doesn't have a beginning outside of Pentecost. Let me say it again. This moving and functioning and flowing and operating in the Holy Ghost has its beginning at Pentecost. Mm-hmm. It's only 9:30. But the expression on some people's face, do you think it's after 1 o'clock in the morning? I'm about to get started. I'm warming up. Just waiting for the reaction of the things of the Spirit in your life. We're just going to camp out here. My wife and I went the other day to a place because it was our anniversary, and they did a 5-course meal. And it's like, I haven't eaten a 5-course meal in a long time. And these people were making this 5-course meal count. It's like every course filled us up. And there's no way we're like eating this, all of this food. And I'm not kidding you. It started at 7 and ended at 8:30. It's an hour and a half of eating. It's like they bring this one thing, you know, and you're like, you know, and you deal with it. And it was very good. It's extremely good. And then they like give you 10, 15 minutes. And then they bring in this other thing. And then this other thing with these spaces of time between it. I couldn't handle that, but I can handle this. I couldn't sleep all night. My stomach's not used to having that much food in it. I'm like, do people eat like this on a regular basis? I can hear my wife laughing right now. The Holy Ghost bears witness with our spirit that we're the children of God. Now think about this, dear people. Because now we're talking about the contrast of the way that we live versus the way that all other human beings on this earth live. The contrast of our dimensions of our heavenly life because we're so given over to the Holy Ghost. Where we don't allow condemnation, where we don't allow fear, where we don't allow earthly interest to captivate our attention or to rule in our passions. Are you with me?
Yeah.
And now Paul brings it to this place. It's almost like a crescendo saying, now the Holy Ghost, because this is what we're doing, the activity of this kind of a lifestyle of giving ourselves over to this ways of heaven. Now God, the Holy Ghost, His Spirit is bearing witness with our spirit that we were born again. That this really did happen in our life. That this is more than religion.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Pentecostal fire. This is almost what Paul's talking about, Pentecostal fire. He's talking about the power of the Holy Ghost, the outpouring of divine glory, the baptism, the life of the Spirit of the living God. The Holy Ghost shall be with you and in you. See, people got all these things they want to say about, you know, how saved the disciples were before Jesus went to the cross. But I'm going to tell you right now, Jesus said to them in John 14, 17, he said, the Holy Ghost is with you, but he will be in you. It was something that was going to happen on another day. It had not happened yet. He was with them, but he was not in them. Hallelujah. In that day, when the Holy Ghost is in you, in that day, when that event happens, then you know to know. Then at that moment in time, you know the Father is in me, that I'm in you, and you're in me. At that moment of revelation, because you become a part of it, because now you now have the Holy Ghost testifying to your spirit that you have been brought into the family, that you belong to the same realm that I myself exist in. Jesus is saying, and I'm just taking it that much further in application of what Paul is describing. It's time for you to quit identifying and letting things define you that belong to your job. I mean, people always talk about their job. They're always discerning what they're supposed to do based upon their job. Or how much money they have in the bank. Oh, no, what am I going to do if I quit my job? I have no idea. You're going to be one lost, wandering little soul in heaven. My job. Where's my need? I'm a woodmaker. I need that. My job. You need to get rid of that. Don't define yourself based upon these things. My money. What's that bank account like, honey? You're in heaven. Wake up. You're in heaven. Do we have enough money to obey God? I believe the Lord told me to go do something. Please check the bank account and see if we can. Go ahead and bow to that thing once again. You have to stop making this. That's a carnal realm. I don't care what you say about it. It is an earth is defining what you're going to do based upon earthly factors. That ain't it. That ain't the life. Living under a life of bondage, a life of fear. Oh, no, we're going to be out in the street. Listen, man, if you're full of the Holy Ghost, you're going to have heaven out in the street. And it'd be different for you because up until the point of your existence, the righteous have never been forsaken. And his children never beg bread. And he's always taken well supplied, taking good care of those people who walk with him. And now you need to be fretful and fearful that after 6,000 years, God might not turn on, I might not show up for you. He might really let you down. You go without. Now, as you walk with the Lord, faith begins to explode in your life. Father does so much more through you. You don't live by money anymore. You don't live by finances anymore. You don't live by money anymore. You live by faith. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You don't have to buy it. You can believe for it. Hallelujah. You don't have to pay for it. You can believe for it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You got to start somewhere. I started basically just stretching myself out and getting things and that I believe that laying hold of things that I believe the Lord wanted me to do, to lay hold on, and I just went into debt for it. Just and then believed for the miracle finances. Had no way to budget for it because there wasn't even any that kind of finances available to me. And then through that process, the Lord just basically graduating me into a realm and I don't even have to pay for it no more. I can just believe for it. Amen. I'm moving into a new phase in God. Some of you could have all the time walked right along with the sinner. You could have grown and matured, but you haven't even gone through the phase yet of paying for it, as it were, and believing God for the finances. You haven't even gone through that phase yet. So when are you going to get with that program? Go ahead and get with that program. Start doing stuff. Start shaking stuff up. Start moving stuff around. Huh? Why don't you become the owner of some resorts so that you can begin to set the atmosphere and have evangelistic means by which you can reach the masses or whatever it is. It's going to cost you several $1 million just to begin. Huh? Maybe 10 or 15 million just to get started. Why don't you get after the program? Huh? Why don't you start stretching yourself out and start doing more than just, you know, trying to hold down the fort till Jesus comes? Huh? Or keep the bills paid rather till Jesus comes. Ah, I'm telling you, keep the gas in the tank and food on the plate. Give me a break. What a meager existence. Talk about small-minded. Come on, people. That's intolerable. Just intolerable. I'd have more sympathy and more concern for people say, you know what, I want the Holy Ghost, but I just don't have the Holy Ghost, and I just don't even know how to yield to Him. I don't even know how to begin. And then I can work with that. That people sit around and say, oh, I'm full of the Holy Ghost, and you haven't done nothing. You haven't hardly done anything. I mean, come on, people. Don't let things steal your hunger. Don't let things steal your thirst by creating imaginations and fantasies of you've done something so great and you haven't done nothing. As far as I'm concerned, I haven't done anything. I've done very little in the kingdom of God. Man, I'm zealous for the Lord. I'm going to do something. Amen. I'm going to lay hold on this realm. Yes. I'm going to lay hold. I'm not going to sit back and wait for another day. I'm going to let somebody else do it. I'm not a bench warmer. Get me in the game, man. I mean, I'm crying out to God, Father, use me. I'm telling you, there's not a great, more desperate prayer. You'll find me, my wife and I, you'll find us awake in the night saying, oh, God, desperately crying out, oh, God, use us. Oh, God, speak to us. Oh, God, fully take hold of every dimension of our life to where that everything about us is simply glorifying you and revealing that which you purpose to do through our lives. I'm just, come on, Lord. Whatever is keeping you from being able to use me more. Oh, Lord, show me. Shine the floodlight of heaven upon me. May I saw that I may get aggressive against it. Yeah. And so Romans chapter 8 begins to help us and causes us to see for those of us who pray such prayers and have such interest, who mind the things of the Holy Ghost rather than earthly things. I'm minding the things of the Holy Ghost. Things of the Holy Ghost is to go reach the lost. Things of the Holy Ghost is to go present heaven to those who've been imprisoned by hell. Things of the Holy Ghost is to set the captives free. Things of the Holy Ghost is to lay hold on the inheritance and the blessings of God and all the giftings of the Spirit and all the fruits of the Spirit. Huh. Things of the Holy Ghost is to be in charge, to find a place in a position of divine authority to where the kings and noblemen and princes and leaders shake in their boots because of the glory that resides on the inside of our lives and in the midst of His church. Come on, people. That's not passive. That's active. I think something just happens because you're hoping one day. That's something you get up and you run. I mean, you are battling ram. You'll bust it down if it's standing in the way. Huh? There has to be that kind of aggression. Otherwise, nothing's going to happen. The zeal of the Lord's going to have to consume you. Otherwise, nothing's going to happen. You're going to be run right over top of. Come on, people. Yeah. Demand it of yourself. Yeah. Demand it of those that are around you. Demand it. Yeah. And then if you're children, then you're heirs of God. Just that simple. And it's not heirs of God to where, you know, all the finances and all the ability and all the authority is there waiting for you till you grow up. Right. And one day when you get to heaven, you can now begin to utilize the resources given. Because that doesn't make any sense. And furthermore, Paul already laid that out for us, or at least is going to lay it out for us in the sequence of the way that the epistles are set up here in the New Testament and say, you're not like a child who's waiting for the inheritance to be entrusted to you. Your sonship means that you had the inheritance entrusted to you. Sonship brings you right into functioning and operating and living in the inheritance. It's just that now you're willing to take a stand in that realm of authority, in that realm of faith, and no matter what comes your way, no matter what pushes against you, no matter what threatens you, you're not moved. You're moving things out of the way. You know, you're going to deal with it and not allow anything to exist that would try to minister something ministered to you that would say otherwise. I'm an heir of God because I'm a son. The Holy Ghost bears witness with my spirit that I'm a child of God because I've given myself over to living and dwelling in the Holy Ghost, not living and dwelling in an earthly existence, oh, concerned about earthly issues, caught away with my own, you know, self-interest. So therefore I'm an heir and a co-inheritor with Jesus. What did I co-inherit with him? God gave him the Holy Ghost without measure. God gave him a name that is above every name, so that now I get to use the and function freely with the authority of the name of Jesus. Not my name, his name. I get to function with the full authority of the name of Jesus Christ and execute that authority on a level that God supplies power and divine ability to deal with whatever needs to be dealt with. Is that got to grow and mature? It does. How does it grow and mature? Just like anything else will grow and mature in your life, because you're actively engaged with it, you're participating with it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is the way that we're strengthened by the Spirit in our inner man. Is the way that we're built up in our most holy faith. Until it gets strong, until it gets powerful, until it gets passionate. And you know what? I'm telling you right now, if you're lazy, you're going to have to get over your laziness. You're going to have to grab yourself by the nap of the neck, because I'm telling you, you can't be lazy flowing in the Holy Ghost, because it is going to demand of yourself, get up and move things around. If you're so used to just going with the wind of the atmosphere, just the wind of the influence, having things, whatever they are, the state of your body, tiredness, whatever, the state and the atmosphere of people's opinions and disposition impacting you and influence you and determining what you are going to do or not going to do, you got yourself a hard road to hoe. Because you're going to have to come up against all of that stuff. Until you find a realm to where now it doesn't have influence over you, you influence it. Now you're beginning to be a part of advancing the kingdom of God. Somebody said, oh, we're trying to create enough money so we can advance the kingdom of God. You got to do nothing with money. Or you do very little. You may be able to sponsor some crusades so long as you sponsor somebody who knows how not to be influenced by the spirit and the prince of the power of the air and the circumstances and the surrounding atmosphere, who knows how to bust through the thing, who knows how to break it wide open. Hallelujah. Papa wants you to learn how to do this. This is the inheritance. He wants you to learn how to live in this heavenly realm. He wants you to learn the access that you have to the Father personally, individually, by the Holy Ghost. Now listen, dear people. Everybody's got equal access, equal opportunity, but only a few people do it. There's only a few people who live in it, who make God their habitation. Everybody else is visiting. And many times what we've seen over and again is it's like Father's got to come and visit you and shake you and say, hey, I'm here. Won't you let me touch you? And you go, wow, you wake up out of your sleep. Wow, what a moving of God. That was amazing. And then you go back to sleep. Spiritually. While the natural existence is wide awake trying to get something done. Come on, people. Live awake and awake, awake. Awake, 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 awake. Awake unto this realm of glory. Awake unto this realm of heavenly living. Oh, Ramandese Dita Kutayana Mahas. Awake unto La Basirini. Awake unto this authority. Awake unto this power. Awake unto this divine commission. Awake, 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 awake. What God would do with you if you would awaken. What God would do with you. He's just waiting on you. You're not waiting on him. Hey, listen, Father's looking for people. To begin to use, you lay hold on God. You stop just, you know, settling out for some small thing. Listen, the things of God are majestic and glorious. You start seeing that which God would do through you to reveal Jesus Christ. I'm going to tell you right now, there'll be plenty of room made for you. Plenty of room in ministry. There's great need of ministry throughout the nations of the earth. And the Lord says to us, he says then, because as you begin, let me just tell you this. It's a beautiful, wonderful thing. As you begin to move and function more in the realms of interacting with the Holy Ghost, every dimension of the spiritual realm becomes far more apparent. Every dimension. The activity of demon spirits, the activity of angels, both heavenly and the realms of the demonic. Because you start entering into a whole other dimension of life. You're entering into an unseen realm. You're participating more with an unseen realm than you are with the seen realm. You're ministering and living more out of heaven than you are out of earth. You're ministering and living more out of the spiritual than out of the natural, out of the physical. I'm telling you, it's a beautiful realm. It's a glorious realm. It's a realm of security in God. It's a realm of knowing you are who you are. It's a realm of empowerment. It's a realm of beauty. It's a realm of what Christ Jesus died and rose again and sent it up on high for us to have. You don't want to miss out on it. It's the realm of victorious living. It's the realm of all that Father has provided for us. Come on, get involved. Understand where you get to go. Understand, praise God for all that you get to engage in right now. I'm going to tell you right now, it's far more than you've even ever touched. It's far more. Some people are like going, oh, well, I'm out of breath, man. It took me all everything I got to get where I'm at. We don't want you to have that. We want you to have the one that's easy, that you don't weary when you run. Because you let God, the Holy Ghost, take the lead. You wait on him. Don't move out. Man means you wait on him. Don't move out without him. Don't speak without him. Don't act without him. Wait on him. Let him lead. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The other day, you know, we were praying for my wife because she had some things going on. Just praying. And first and foremost, I said, I see you foul spirit oppressing my wife. In the name of Jesus, you take your stinking hands off her. Every lying thing of hell in Jesus' name. And I began to just minister to, baby, you, spirit of God dwells on the inside of you. You don't have to have any of this. You know that now. We're not going to allow it. You stand up against it. Don't you lie down to it. Just one thing after another hitting her. And so, praying like that, I woke up and the Spirit of the Lord said, she's lacking nutrients, certain nutrients. Isn't that beautiful? And the Lord does it. She's eating the wrong food. I said, sweetheart, what have you been eating? And she listed the stuff that she's been eating. I said, you got to be kidding me. You know better than that. And then we just pulled out the champion juicer and grabbed the spinach and the beets and the carrots and the celery and the, you know, all these other things that we, you know, identified for, you know, the right ratios of calcium and magnesium, just things that the body needs. And then I spoke in the name of Jesus out of your levels come to normal right now. We're not going to have to wait 6-7 months for your levels to come normal. Your levels come normal, now you start eating the right food. Because you can pray for the miracle, but if you're not getting food, you know, you're just eating things that aren't giving you the food. It's just filling you up. It's not giving you the food that you need. See, the Lord gives us wisdom. He gives us insight. He gives us the answer. Sometimes it's just a divine healing because it's an organ that's gone haywire. Other times, it's just simply things that you're not eating right. You don't have the right kind of diet. The Lord gave my wife and I some instructions about how we're supposed to exercise because he's purposed us to glorify him in our bodies. And we're going to listen to God in every dimension of life. We're not just going to have, oh, well, God, we listen to you over here, but the rest of it belongs to us. Come on, man. If God tells you something, you do it. And if you don't do it, you're going to move no further with God. You're going to stay right where you're at until you obey God. Don't care how much God loves you. Don't care how much you love God. Doesn't matter how much we love you, how much you love us, until you obey God. Do what God told you to do, no matter what it costs you. You're not moving on. He's just going to bring you right back to that. He said, you weren't willing to do that. You had all your list of excuses of why you couldn't do that, and why you weren't willing to do that, and why you didn't have to do that. And the Holy Ghost will leave you right there. He loves you, but he'll leave you right there. You're on the shelf. We'll walk by and look at you. Praise God. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank God for his mercy and his grace. But you on the shelf, man. You're not willing to obey. There's certain things you're not willing to do. I pray tonight in the name of Jesus that there's not a single person in here that from this day forward that you'd be unwilling to obey God. When God tells you something to do it, do it.
Yes.
Do it.
Yes.
Do it.
Yes.
Father tells you, get up and run 4 miles. Get up and run 4 miles. Huh? God tells you, go on a fast. Go on a fast. Whatever God tells you to do. God tells you to dress different, dress different. Tells you to act different, act different. Hallelujah. He's supplied all that you have need of to be able to do this. This is the practical flowing in the Holy Ghost. That's what Romans chapter 8 is all about. And this is outlining for us the ability to fulfill what God said to us to do. By the time he gets to verse 29, be conformed to the image of the Son. You're not going to be conformed to the image of the Son. In other words, you're not going to look like, act like Jesus, talk like Jesus, move like Jesus, function in the power and the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ, unless you're willing to move in the function in the realms of the Holy Ghost and submit yourself to what Father has said to do. Define your life based upon his will. Quit living your life after the desires of men. Self-interest. Father's got a bigger plan for you. He wants you to be a representative of heaven. He wants you to flow in the authority and the power of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Father, there's nothing that we don't want anything in our life. We don't want anything in terms of the way that we dress, the way that we look, the way that we behave, to exist in our life that is not of you. And Lord, we know that you have shown us the majesty and the splendor, and so we want to get rid of all the ugly tonight.
Yes.
Yes. Hallelujah. I want the majesty and splendor. Wouldn't you like to be able to have majesty and splendor instead of just the common? Come on, man. It's so beautiful to see people captivated by the realms of the ministry of the Holy Ghost where there is no condemnation. So beautiful to see people so captivated by the Holy Ghost that the manifestation of the Spirit of life is being revealed upon their countenance and their actions and their demeanor and their movements. Hallelujah. It's so beautiful to see the ways, the righteousness and the glory of God, the activity of all that Father has given, his mind, his thinking, his words, his actions, the display of his person in our life, because we're moving and flowing in this wonderful gift that he supplied. Come on, people. All you got to do is trade in your ugly for his beauty. All you got to do is train in your mourning for his oil of joy. All you got to do is trade in your spirit of heaviness for the mantle of praise. Oh, it's beautiful to see. It's rare to see the mantle of praise upon people. Holy Ghost praise. Matured spirit of the Lord praise. Oh, come on, people. It's in the house. Why don't you have it? Why don't you go ahead and take it? It's part of your inheritance. It's part of that which he's given you when you co-inherited with Jesus Christ. This wonderful flow of heaven. Hallelujah. You have, it's coming at expense. It comes at expense. You cannot be so fascinated and infatuated and, you know, with yourself. You had to just become just like only thing that's valuable to me and meaningful to me, oh God, is you. Lord, I have no beauty except for that which you give. I have no ability to speak except for the speech that you supply. I can't even think right unless you think. He says, if you suffer with him, you be glorified together with him. He says, I reckon that the suffering of this present time is not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creature waits for the manifestation of the sons of God. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who subjected the same in hope. He's talking about the body being dead because of sin, the body being corruptible, the body going to a place of death, even though we're not under the law of sin and death. Paul basically emphasizing that, yes, we're still going to die. As he displays this, as it were, complete separation from all of that realm, describing the life that we have in the Holy Ghost. If he didn't emphasize these things, you know, some people would think, my goodness, we're not going to even die anymore. You know, we're so untouchable, because we are. And every dimension except for one, that this body is going to lay down and breathe out its last breath, and a transition is going to take place. And we get clothed with the heavenly, we be clothed upon with the heavenly. He says, but he continues to talk about the sons of God and the children of God and the manifestations of the sons of God and the children of God, which has already been established that we are them. We are it if we're walking in the Holy Ghost. That's what's going on. And here's its impact of the glory of the sonship being manifested through our life. Its impact on every dimension of creation. You know, the creation groans and travails even until now, Paul says right here. But when we begin to walk in this wonderful realms of the Holy Ghost, then the prophet Isaiah says, you go forth in peace, you enjoy and you're led forth in peace, and the mountains and the hills break forth in the singing, and all the trees of the field clap their hands. I'm telling you, that's not groaning no more. That's people now. That's the sonship. That's the glory of redemption, the outpouring of the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of the Lord, the promise of the Spirit, the promise of the Father having been given to those that have been willing to call upon his name. And Paul is just describing the impact of us functioning and flowing in this sonship ministry, this life that is only revealed because we live and dwell in the Holy Ghost. Somebody said, how do I live and dwell in the Holy Ghost? You come to rely upon him. How do I come to rely upon him? You fundamentally stay in Pentecost, the expression of that which God has given, the entrance gift, the ascension gift. Because all of a sudden you're going to find yourself built up in the most holy faith. You're going to find yourself strengthened. You're going to find yourself mature. And you're going to find a place where now you understand more about yielding your members to him than you would any other dimension, any other way of interaction, any other relationship plan. God gave us the best plan when he gave us this plan. Hallelujah. Being filled with this. Fildorabateya. Is the most closely defined expression to the rivers that Jesus talked about in John chapter 7 than any other expression. You hear me? Because that's what took place. Jesus, now being glorified, has received the promise of the Father. Having received the promise of the Father, has poured forth that which you see and hear. The promise of the Father. Go tarry in Jerusalem until you receive the promise of the Father. Luke 24:48. Acts 1:4. The promise of the Father. The gift of the Holy Ghost. Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? Has the Spirit of the Lord, have you allowed the Holy Ghost to be poured out upon your flesh, upon your body, upon your being, so that he's with you and in you, so that you're immersed in him, surrounded by him, led by him, guided by him, taught by him, where that you are an active participant in that which God is going to teach you, And you wake up, if you wake up sorrowful and sad, you begin to pray in the Holy Ghost until you get glad, because you know you're going to be a false witness if you walk out the door looking like that. Makeup can't cover that ugly up. Are you listening to me? The love isn't there. If the peace isn't there, if the boldness isn't there, if the faith isn't there, all you're going to be is a false witness. You're not able. All you're going to be is a testimony of your existence in this world. And God has called you to such high, much higher things than that. He wants to test you to testify of Papa's existence, of Christ Jesus' existence, of who He is. Hallelujah. Yes. Hallelujah. Yes. Hallelujah. 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 Bambro borrevedina mangalia romomba babibi ribos to remain in an angel she ruaya. Haramand leelaya ushikaya. Hallelujah. Likewise, just going to jump right to verse 26. Likewise, the Holy Ghost helps our infirmities, our weaknesses. For we do not know what we should pray as we ought, but the Holy Ghost makes intercession. He makes intercession for us with groanings which could not be uttered. God, the Holy Ghost, is praying. You may not even hear Him praying. And really, groanings, I really believe it should be inexpressible utterances. Inexpressible utterances can be longings like hunger and thirst. He produces hunger in us and thirsting in us. Because we give ourselves over to the activity of that which He supplies. Begins to affect. I want you to hear this. It begins to affect your passions, your emotions, your appetites, your attitudes. You need to bottle sofravanaya until every one of your passions, your emotions, your attitudes are measurably affected. Counts for nothing. It's going to affect nothing. It's going to just wear you out. Come on now. It may sound a little similar, but it's the saboranaya. Berefitinamiki. Is the aramosaranaya. Is the ranosi in the mekikianakia. Is the utterances of God. O ramon zezi lubaya. Hallelujah. I rimon zozi alingaju. Hallelujah. Ye ramon de brede. Hallelujah. 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 And the one who searches the heart knows what is the mind of the Holy Ghost, because He makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. Hallelujah. What prayer? What intercession? What supplication? What ability? What resources that Father has made available to us? And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to His purposes. Hallelujah. And then Brunanase. Handale Gidi Birinjishta. Hallelujah. I know it. That's why I can be happy. Hallelujah. In all my tribulations, instead of getting frustrated, I'm in the middle of a heavenly plan. Sometimes I'm hard of hearing, so we find ourselves coming up against things that are contrary to our will. I was going down the road. I'll give you an example. I was going down the road, and the Spirit of the Lord said to me, turn off over here. And I just know I'm going to go up here. And I got stuck in a traffic fatal accident, stuck there 5 hours. Just recently happened. And then they put us on a detour and went on the detour, and two trucks jackknifed, so that got shut down. And so we got turned back around to the place that the Lord told me to turn off to. He prevented the madness of the prophet. I kid you not. Every avenue I went down, it was blocked. I had to go all the way back 50 miles to turn into the road. The Lord said, just turn here. I'm telling you. Hallelujah. And then you know that if when you got the master's plan like that, you might as well just go ahead and give thanks in that 5 hours of sitting there in the traffic. And then you think you're on a detour and you're on your way now. We're on our way now. And then everybody's all backed up and says, well, what's going on up there? Might as well turn around. They all jackknifed up there on the bridge. Nobody's going to get through. Okay, well then, Father, I know I'm right here in the middle of your plan. I'm just going to go ahead and give thanks. What are we doing now? Well, let's try another way. Never thought to think, just wait a minute. He did tell me to turn off the road back there 50 miles. I need to go back 50 miles. Let's try another way. Because why? I'm pursuing my will. And that's just a very physical realm in which we describe things that happen in the spiritual, even in a much less obvious fashion. And so you might as well go ahead and give thanks, because I'm going to tell you right now, he's going to get you turned back around. Huh? You might as well give thanks, because all you're upset about is it not working out according to your will and plan. But he's going to get you turned around to get in his will and plan. And that he is, I tell you right now.
This is amazing how much he loves us.
For, because listen to this, and he really wraps this up into this, into the dimension of the activity of the Holy Ghost and the purpose of the Holy Ghost, to where that we find ourselves now being directed by God, and prevented really in many respects from our own wills, what we would rather pursue, so long as we're saying, Father, I want to learn to do it your way. He's going to, because we don't get that. We don't understand that. We have a hard time discerning, so he's going to give us eyes to see and abilities to understand. So he says, listen, whom he foreknew, he also predestinated to be conformed to the image of the Son. So he's going to get that job done. Hey, hallelujah. He began a good work in you. He's going to finish it. He's going to get that done as long as you're going to participate. Huh? Huh? But you can't sit there all muley going, You're going to have to get up and start moving around a little bit here. It's because I want you to sit there and understand how he's going to get it done, how he's showing us how he's going to get it done. It's because he says, because those who he did predestinate, he also called. Look at that. Mm-hmm. You didn't choose me, I chose you. And this is a kumpum. Ilamujirisha. I don't know about everybody that's already left, but as far as everybody's still here, yes. No. I'm sure people just, they're not used to, we didn't even sing tonight. And they're just not used to sitting this long. Unless it's watching a movie.
That's true. Yeah, way to go.
Or a football game or some other earthly interest that fascinates the senses of the earthly existence and saturates you with impulses and stimulation that runs contrary to reality and that which God would develop you in. So you stuck in a stinking sensual realm. SSS. Stuck. In a stinking sensual realm. Whom he called, he justified, he made righteous. I stand before the Lord right now, holy and acceptable, being everything that he ever purposed me to be, because I stand here now in Christ Jesus. What a beautiful place of existence. What great peace. What great certainty, boldness, confidence it works in our life. And he says, whom he also justified, them he also glorified. Already done. Glorified. He's put his glory upon me, so he has glorified me. It's already done. This is a dimension of being glorified, which made it all that much more, because Paul's driving it such an unlimited realm of living and dwelling in God that he had to step back and highlight the fact that, yeah, our body's still on its way to a place called death. And yes, sickness and disease and problems and health issues work within that dimension. But not to worry, because that Holy Ghost, the same Holy Ghost that's activating every other part and dimension of your life, shall also make alive your mortal body wherever you have a need. Yeah. How many of you have physical needs in here? Raise your hand. You have physical needs. Let's get them healed. Let's get them healed. I don't care what it is. It doesn't matter what it is. It doesn't matter whether, what dimension of health problems. Listen, some of you are overweight. That's a health problem. It's a health problem. You need to get that fixed. Some of you have issues within the framework of just female problems. Some of the ladies that are getting older, just get it fixed. Holy Ghost dwells in you, inside of you, get it fixed. You can supernaturally lose weight. You can supernaturally have your hormones adjusted. You can supernaturally have nutrition. There's some times where we've had to eat things that we knew wasn't good, but what we did was we prayed, said, Father, supernaturally make this healthy to our body. Put the minerals and the vitamins in it that we need to be healthy. Let's get this thing underway. Let's stand up against the pain. Let's stand up against the issues. Let's stand up against the even physiological issues, maybe bones that are out of alignment. It's too bad your daughter didn't come tonight and bring her children and your son-in-law. Come sit in the presence of the Lord. They just want a quick handshake and a praise God, hallelujah, and it's all done. Now you need to sit in the presence of God. Because the little guy's got a busted thumb. Smashed bone. You need to sit in the presence of God. You need to sit long in the presence of God. People need to have more of an appetite for spiritual things. What we're doing here is a Holy Ghost thing, a spiritual thing. It runs counter to all the rest of the stuff that most people interested in want to do. They're living their life by the dictates of earthly concerns and interest. And it ain't going to get you far. God loves you. His mercy is extended towards you. But it ain't going to establish that which Father's purpose to establish. You're going to miss out on the means by which you and I learn how to receive that which is freely given. What shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, but offered him up or delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things?